Good morning. Once again, my name is Lloyd Day. I'm the Deputy Director General of the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation on Agriculture, ICA. I am pleased to welcome you all to day number two of this two-day webinar discussing the importance of livestock production and animal protein, a Western Hemisphere perspective. ICA is grateful for the sponsorship and collaboration of the U.S. Dairy Export Council that has been our partner on this webinar, and a prior event in September in which we discussed the role of dairy in a responsible and sustainable food system. Today's webinar will bring together expert perspectives from throughout the Western Hemisphere to debate some of the most pressing issues facing livestock production and to share current scientific knowledge and expert perspectives on the important role of animal production and animal protein in a sustainable food system, and to explore opportunities and challenges for the future. Internationally renowned experts will share their experiences, research, and perspectives on these subjects. Yesterday, we spoke about sustainable production, nutritional and health implications of animal protein, and farmer perspectives and priorities. We heard a lot about the importance of science underscoring everything we do to promote increased production, animal care and welfare, and the vital contribution of animal source protein to nutrition and human health. We also heard from speakers discussing the skyrocketing demand in developing economies for more, not less, animal protein, and how we can reduce deforestation while increasing productivity to meet global food demands and restore degraded lands through agroforestry projects. Finally, and importantly, we discussed how we need our food system to address two significant crises: malnutrition and a changing climate, and how we need to look holistically at these challenges and how they affect the economy, society, human health, and the environment. Today's session will cover innovation, research, and development to support sustainable production, including advances in animal nutrition and genetics, the social and economic importance of livestock production, and finally, consumer perceptions of livestock farming, enhancing understanding today and in the future of how to communicate about the themes of greatest interest and how to better tell the story of the contributions of animal agriculture to sustainable food systems. The contributions by these experts for both seminars will be published later in the year and serve as part of our contribution to the United Nations Food Systems Summit in 2021. Today's webinar will be held in English with simultaneous interpretation to Spanish and Portuguese. In addition to the presentations, discussions will be facilitated by industry experts to promote audience interaction through your chat function, please. Our introductory session will include Ted McKinney, Undersecretary for Trade and Foreign Agricultural Affairs at the United States Department of Agriculture; Marcelo Brito, the President of the Brazilian Agribusiness Association, ABAG; and Caio Pinedo, the President of the Brazilian Roundtable on Sustainable Production. So we have a lot to cover today, and I'd like to get things started by asking Undersecretary Ted McKinney, a good friend of ICA and of farmers and ranchers everywhere, to provide some opening remarks. Undersecretary McKinney, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Lloyd, and I'll presume that I'm coming through okay. It is just great to see you. I have been in that wonderful, beautiful assembly room there in Costa Rica at IECA headquarters, and it's good to see and be familiarized with that, and to see so many people here on the screen with me, several who I know, and if I don't know you, I certainly know of you by your very good reputation, and not to mention the many, many other people who you have assembled here from countries around the world. From the head and the heart, I've got to say, Lloyd, that IECA, more than any international or regional organization I know, fulfills the vision that we see others pursuing. And for you all to do this, like you have done so many others, is just unbelievable. I looked through carefully the two-day agenda, most notably looking at the speakers, and this is perhaps one of the best lineup and perhaps one of the most diverse lineup of speakers that I've seen, particularly on this topic. And so I just want to congratulate all of those who are both participating, but particularly those who organized it, because you've got a humdinger here, and I'll look forward to that readout if I can use that word, that you said would be out in a few weeks or months, because I have not been able to, my schedule just does not allow me to sit through all of this, but I surely would like to at least read the high level. So congratulations, Taika, and all that you do. You're a model for so many others. I just wanted to share a couple thoughts. Many of you might know that we're reaching out a great deal more with the Secretary's and USDA's innovation agenda. And part of that is because we need to. We in agriculture don't talk enough about these kinds of things. We're just proud to do our work. I'm sort of speaking from a farmer's point of view now, happy to do our work, produce things, very environmentally sustainable. And yet we don't talk about the good news about what we do, farmers as the first environmentalists, and I still say one of the best classes of environmentalists. So we are reminding ourselves of what sustainability means. And most of you know this, but I'm going to just say it because it bears repeating. We've always understood, I have always understood, that sustainability is a three-legged stool. Without any doubt, it needs to be attentive to the environmental sustainability, our land, our water, our air. And I think correctly, that's getting more and more attention today. So hooray for that. That's a good thing. Then there's the social sustainability. And I think that means different things to different people, but it's taking care of the societies that we have. Do we have the resources there for subsequent generations? Are we doing right by society? And I think that's getting much more attention. But I'm going to remind people that economic sustainability is also, and that means different things, but I've always interpreted that to be first, can a farmer or a rancher make a profit? They're contributing so much to the world that we need for them to be able to make a profit. And that is slipping in a major way, at least in parts of the world. And I hope that does not include North America or those of us in the Western Hemisphere that you serve, Lloyd, Aika serves. So that's a reminder how we look at it. And that is what's driving the innovation agenda. The Secretary has acknowledged, certainly I've spoken about this since I was a kid giving 4-H and FFA speeches, that we all know what Norman Borlaug did to address famine and hunger in the days of the 1970s when the Green Revolution was going on. It was one of my great honors to hold just a few of the wheat seeds from those semi-dwarf wheat varieties that are still housed at the wonderful, wonderful Cimit facility just outside of Mexico City. What a source of pride. I still have a photo and it's up in my office here in that regard. It's that kind of thing that we have got to chase more and more and more. So the Secretary's got a goal of increasing productivity, at least in our country, by 40% and reducing the load on the environment by 50%. The key difference between us and other parts of the world is we're going to do that through innovation. Our farm has achieved that. Our fertilizer use is down by 25 to 35% because we're dialing in, we have soil sampling, and we're taking those things down. Similarly, we're using zero insecticide in our corn planting these days, and that's because of the advent of biotechnology traits, the so-called GMOs. So for those around the world that believe we need to cut these things or ban them, I beg of you, rethink your position. You can do that through innovation and continue to rise in productivity. And that includes meats and dairy, which I think is much more the focus of this conference. And that's great because so many of them focus only on plants. We cannot, shall not, will not forget all of the products that come from our livestock and poultry sector. Why is all this important? Well, my world these days is international trade. And I say to many people that although I've got a lot of friends out there, the idea of competition, eat or get eaten, a cynic might say screw or get screwed, that's alive and well out there. And shame on all of us who do that. I strive to break that barrier down. I strive to make sure that I help somebody as much as they are helping me out. That's the way we're going to bring safe quality food in an efficient, the most efficient manner. And yes, I'm pulling from my ag econ days as I talk about that. And so if we can break down those barriers, follow science as I was taught science, and as some of these people who are here now are talking science, I think we have a very, very bright future. And we're going to make our productivity needs for those 9 to 10 billion people projected to be on the planet by 2050. So I say all that's important. In the run-up to this UN Food System Summit, I think this is a fantastic thing that we're doing. And as much as I'm very positive on how this could come out, I'm very worried that there are false agendas being advanced that are going to try to take us back to the days of my grandfather. And we know what they're like. And we cannot do that. And that's why I think this summit, in its work toward reminding people that innovation, safety, quality, and productivity and efficiency is the pathway that I think most of the world chooses. And so I'll just say a huge, enormous, and sincere thank you to those who are speaking today, those that spoke yesterday, for advancing that very agenda, because that's what we've got to pursue. So I'm thrilled to be a part of this for even just a little while. And to some of the speakers, I'm going to look forward to trying to get your recordings or your summaries later. I know some of you, and I know you well, and I know your speeches and your talks well. Can't hear enough. Lloyd, back to you. Thank you so much, everyone. Good luck.
Thanks, Secretary McKinney. I fondly look at the office behind you there, because I used to work just across that door right behind you. So it's great to hear you, and thank you very much for your support. What we're doing here will hopefully be a tool that we can give ministers of agriculture like you to take to their presidents and to defend agriculture at this important food summit next year. So thank you very much for your time. I'd now like to call upon Marcelo Brito, the president of the Brazilian Agribusiness Association. Mr. Brito, the floor is yours.
Bom dia, boa tarde a todos, dependendo aí de que parte, em que país se encontram. É um prazer imenso estar aqui com vocês. Muito obrigado ao ICA pelo convite. Horace.
It is a pleasure to be here with you. I wanted to congratulate you for this event. I believe this is a very particular moment. In the current world, there are strong dichotomies. When we look at the development model, we see that several generations have been able to put on the table important innovations, not this product or the other. Currently, in today's world, there is a debate going on that takes us to one side or to the other. And when we speak about food, this is a major issue where technologies for the new food products will come to replace the traditional food systems. Mainstream is much larger, and there will be very important technologies in the market, and we need to remind ourselves that this has been going on for quite a while. I come from a very big sector. And when we saw the switch from animal protein to plant protein, then people said that this was not good for our health. And the sector kept evolving. Nothing was lost. So some of my friends talk about fake foods, milk that is not milk, meat that is not meat. What I see is that there are many supplements in the market. One of these days, my daughter asked me to buy her a vegetable burger, but she loves grilling during the weekends. So there are people that would like to have a balanced diet with different kinds of food. So those of us who are working in the agribusiness sector, in the food sector, we need to read and interpret what consumers are demanding in terms of food production. Recently, we conducted a study to determine whether the Brazilian agribusiness had a bad image abroad. And when we looked at the result of that study, we determined that agribusiness is under pressures that come from other sectors. We apologize, we lost the interpretation. The sector is negatively impacted. So there are some impacts coming from the government. And that's what happened with the deforestation in the Amazon region. That has a negative impact on the Brazilian agribusiness sector. Our livestock production is very good. I know many livestock businesses in Brazil. I think we're on the right path, and we need to interpret the expectations of the new generations, the new trends in terms of consumption. That is what we need to do. We need to adapt in a smart manner and continuously improve to keep working for those who are the reason for the work we do, that is consumers. Thank you for organizing this event.
Thank you very much, Mr. Brito. We'd now like to stay in Brazil and move to Caio Penido, the president of the Brazilian Roundtable on Sustainable Production. Caio, the floor is yours.
Bom dia a todos, boa tarde. É realmente um prazer estar aqui discutindo a importância da produção.
Thank you. Good afternoon. It is a pleasure to be here and talk about animal protein and animal production and talk about the Brazilian production. We are talking about sustainable production, something which can only be articulated by countries that have a live biodiversity. I am the chair of GTBS, a working group in Brazil, where we are discussing. On the table, we have the beef producers, civil society, the consumers, banks, all of us are discussing how to produce and preserve this biodiversity. And we see the core challenges worldwide, food safety, food security, and we see also an increase in the global population worldwide, where we foresee that by 2050, the population will be way over 10 billion inhabitants. And this is exerting great pressure on productivity and also causes great deforestation. So we are facing a second global challenge that we have been discussing also, and that is climate change. The risk of a temperature increase on the planet can limit food production. Well, now, what is the relevance of forest? What is their importance? Why this debate on the existence of forests that are carbon sinkholes? They preserve water, and all this water helps regulate climate, particularly, and the Amazon region that is, the roots of the trees take the moisture from the soil, and this is passed on to the atmosphere and irrigates distant areas in the Amazon region to balance the whole climate situation in the whole world. Well, why is Brazil so important to help the world in these two areas? Well, Brazil can produce much more than it currently produces. Today, we have areas that were deforested, but that have very low productivity. These are areas, degraded areas, depleted areas. So we can help improve those areas once again and enrich and enhance and strengthen the soil. And we can foster more pasture lands to improve this carbon balance and reduce carbon emissions. So what, and all of this we want to do within the Brazilian Forestry Code, where we have the protection of biodiversity. That is why Brazil is so important. We can produce more by reducing emissions and preserving biodiversity, particularly in the Amazon region. Now, what is our plan of action for this? Well, we want to implement our forestry code. This is a code that has been discussed by the society at large, approved by the National Congress. And we need to put it into practice. The Brazilian land use and conservation land code, excuse me, is very important for us. The articles in the code foresee assigning a value to the living, assign a value to the forest because it is so important for the Brazilian environment. And we want to continue promoting agriculture and livestock development, where we have the low emissions ABC plan, which has been promoted by Embrapa. Brazil, among those challenges, we see unique characteristics. This is it has the biggest biodiversity on Earth. Today, we have more than 60% of our territory focused on conservation. These are areas that could very well be producing, and we are preserving more than 60%. We have one of the cleanest electricity grids in the whole world, and basically a good, most of our cattle are raised with grasslands, and we see the effects this has had on the greenhouse gases. Our image throughout the world, I mean, people should see us with very good eyes throughout the whole world, because we are helping a lot. But at the same time, we are being surprised all of a sudden by these, by some of these campaigns that go against us, and an international strategy that I don't know, I really don't know where it comes from, but this is a strategy basically to harm, to weaken our image as a country that is protecting the environment, and which affects our implementation of these forestry code. The biggest power in the world is recognized as being the one that is deforesting the Amazon region. What would be the solution? What would be a new strategy? We are going, we cannot harm a country's vision to move forward. We need a strategy creating a global market for credit carbon credits, where emitting countries can neutralize their consumption, purchasing these credits from other countries that have, for example, an untouched biodiversity. So instead of affecting the countries, basically, we should all join together and help countries that are providing environmental services so that they be paid for that. The forest today provides environmental services, but we are not being paid for that. But there is a cost for this conservation. So I believe that to restructure that strategy could begin by creating that market, this environmental credit and carbon market. I thank you all very much, and I hope I have collaborated a bit with our discussion for the day. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kayo. I think you articulated the importance of having a global approach to how we discuss these the three legs of this stool, as Secretary McKinney discussed. We had a wonderful presentation yesterday by Fernando Sampai, who is the Executive Director of Produce, Conserve, Include, who kind of gave us all a kind of agricultural 101 course on production in Brazil and how you're working to balance production and growth in production to meet global demands, while at the same time dealing with a lot of the pressures of the whole world focused on the environment and sustainability and deforestation and things like that. So it's very important that Brazil is a significant contributor to this this discussion, as well as an important friend and partner of IECA's. So we're grateful to both of you and to Secretary McKinney for your introductory comments. We're now gonna move into the first panel of the day, innovation, research, and development to support sustainable production. The session will explore the importance of developing and evaluating new technologies, tools, and innovations to aid producers in producing more food for more people using less resources and at a lower cost. A central tenet underlying progress will be the importance of science and data driving decision-making, adoption, and new best practices. Advances in animal nutrition and genetics will also be featured. Our first speaker is Frank Mittlener, who's a professor of air quality specialist in the cooperative extension in the Department of Animal Science at the University of California, Davis. He received his master's in animal science and agricultural engineering from the University of Leipzig, Germany, and his PhD in animal science from Texas Tech. Dr. Mittlener is an expert for agricultural air quality, livestock housing, and husbandry. Overall, he conducts research that is directly relevant to understanding and mitigating air emissions from livestock operations, as well as the implications of these emissions for the health and safety of farm workers and neighboring communities. Dr. Mittlener, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Lloyd. And thank you for IECA for having me. It's a great honor and pleasure for me to talk to you today. So I was asked to talk about sustainability, and obviously being an expert in this area of air quality.
Frank, we see your presentation, but we don't hear you.
Oh, you don't hear me. All right, let's see. You don't hear me. You don't hear me now?
Frank, it looks like you're off mute now. Can we see if we hear you?
Okay, can you hear me now?
No, we're not hearing you.
You're not hearing me. Oh.
Do you hear me now?
All right, some people are hearing you. Hear me now? We're not hearing you in the main cella.
Huh. That's very strange.
Okay, please continue. Please continue. People are hearing you.
Oh, people are hearing me. Oh, that's good. Right, let me go back to my slide. So, I just thank the organizers for having me. And when I prepared for this talk, I thought about what would be the most important.
Can you give us a moment? The interpreters are not hearing you. It seems like we have some glitch here in IECA. One moment.
Okay.
Please.
Sure.
Frank, we might wait and see if we can move ahead with Elena and see if we can correct your the difficulty. Elena, can you test if we hear you?
Hello, can you hear me? Hello?
All right, I'm sorry. We're not hearing you either, Elena. One moment, please. All right, Frank, I think I'm getting a request for you to try and speak again.
Okay, test, one, two, test, 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 no, one, two. Yeah, it seems like you have an issue there with that line to the interpreters. But the interpreters did hear Ted, correct?
So it appears that people are hearing people on YouTube, but not here on the Zoom channel. So we're trying to resolve that. If you could just bear with us a moment, please. Thank you.
Of course.
Frank, can we test again, please?
Yes, yes, test, one, two, Wes, test, test, one, two.
Thanks, Frank.
Oh, I see head shaking. That's not a good sign.
Un, dos, tres.
Hey, Frank, can we test again, please?
Yep, test, one, two, test, test, one, two.
Great, we hear you just fine. Let's proceed.
Thank Excellent.
You. Thanks for your
All right. Oh, no problem at all. And you still see my slides, correct? You don't see my slides.
No slides.
No slides. This is interesting.
Just do it again. Maybe just start over with the slides, sharing them.
Okay. All right, let me see here. How do I do this? Share screen.
Yeah, we're seeing them now.
All right, excellent. So I trust that everything works now. I had been pondering as to what sustainability topic to talk about, because there are many, but one in particular that I think is really changing the narrative around livestock. When it comes to environmental sustainability, the discussion is oftentimes around greenhouse gases, and here in particular around methane. I want to share with you the findings that are really, in my opinion, changing the narrative around livestock's impact on climate. I call this project Rethinking Methane. Some of that will become somewhat technical, and I'm aware that the audience is not into greenhouse gases per se, but I think I will be able to break it down in ways that make sense. If some of what I do say does not make sense, then please also know that I make available this video here. It's called Rethinking Methane, and it's posted on YouTube. It has reached hundreds of thousands of people already. It's a 5-minute video that does, I think, a good job in explaining everything I'm about to share with you. First of all, when it comes to greenhouse gases, then the discussion is oftentimes about how potent methane is. And it's true, methane is a potent greenhouse gas, meaning it has a high ability to trap heat from the sun. It generally is compared to other greenhouse gases such as carbon dioxide or nitrous oxide in what's called the global warming potential. This is how greenhouse gases have been compared for over the last few decades. However, as we see now, and as you will see in a few minutes, there is a serious issue with that. So it is true methane is a potent greenhouse gas, but it is not true that it can easily be compared to the other greenhouse gases. And I will tell you why. First of all, this slide here shows the global methane budget. You see on the left side that there are different sources of methane, such as fossil fuel production on the left, agriculture and waste, biomass burning, and so on. All of these sources amounting to a total of 560 teragrams, that's the unit, 560 teragrams of methane per year globally. What a lot of the people who report on methane do leave out is that methane is not just produced, as you see on this slide, but methane is also destroyed, as you will see on the right side. So while methane is produced globally at 560 teragrams, it's destroyed at 550 teragrams. In other words, methane is not net emitted at 560, but net emitted at 10 teragrams per year. Obviously, a huge difference. What is it that destroys methane? Well, here on this slide, it's depicted as a sink from chemical reactions in the atmosphere. That sink is referred to as oxidation. A methane molecule in the air meets another molecule called a radical. The radical steals something away from methane and destroys it. And it takes a very short period of time. And that brings me to the next important fact or factoid around methane, namely its lifespan. When CO2 or the other greenhouse gas nitrous oxide, both of them long-lived, are in the atmosphere, they stay there for a very long time. In the case of CO2, 1,000 years, meaning when you, for example, drive your car and you burn gas, then you put CO2 into the atmosphere. That CO2 stays there for 1,000 years. And every time you drive your car again, you add additional new CO2 to the atmosphere. But if you look at methane, methane does not have a long lifespan, but only one of 10 years. After 10 years, methane is gone. It's gone. Because there is this process called oxidation. And I will lead you through how that works. So if you go back to your high school years, you might remember the concept of photosynthesis, by which plants that are depicted here as grass need several things to grow. They need sunlight, they need water, and they need carbon. And that carbon they need comes from the atmosphere in form of CO2. So the carbon that all plants need, whether they're grasses or grains or anything else, the carbon they need is obtained from atmospheric CO2. Really important, okay? That carbon in the form of CO2 goes into the plants during photosynthesis, is converted into carbohydrates, such as cellulose or starch, and then our livestock eats those carbohydrates. And in the case of ruminant livestock, some of that carbon that was now in the plant is converted into methane, CH4, and belched out by these animals, or it stems from their manure. This carbon contained in this methane molecule, that CH4 here, that carbon is not new carbon to our environment. It's recycled carbon that originated in atmospheric CO2. In other words, the carbon in the methane that stems from livestock is not new carbon to our air, to our climate, but it is recycled carbon, and that's very important. After 10 years, this methane molecule meets a radical and undergoes a process called oxidation. To be precise, hydroxyl oxidation. And then that methane is converted back into CO2. It goes into the atmospheric pool of CO2 from where plants suck up CO2 for renewed photosynthesis. In other words, the methane situation that we find our livestock in is one of recycled carbon. Constant livestock herds, mark my words, constant livestock herds do not add new additional carbon to the atmosphere. Constant livestock herds do not add new additional warming to our Earth's climate. But constant methane will have a net zero effect, and you will see that in a minute. Now, that does not mean that methane is not important. It doesn't mean that at all. In fact, methane is very important, but a constant source of methane will emit methane at the same rate that methane is destroyed. And that is a function of its chemical properties and behaviors, which I will show and share with you in a minute. The situation of other greenhouse gases that stem, for example, from fossil fuel is very different. So while biogenic carbon from livestock goes through a cycle, fossil carbon, let's say from oil, coal, and gas, goes through a different process. So what are fossil carbon? What is fossil fuel? It's oil, coal, and gas. And originally that fossil carbon was plant and animal material from a long, long time ago. These plants and animals died, they decomposed, and they fossilized. And that fossil material, and we are talking really about hundreds of millions of years of fossilized carbon that got stored in the ground as oil, coal, and gas. And over the last 70 years, 70 that is, we have extracted half of all that carbon. We've extracted it and we've burned it. And that carbon is now in the atmosphere. And that is what most climate scientists will agree upon is the main culprit of human contributions to climate change, namely the use of fossil fuels. In the United States and in most developed countries, over 80%, and that's 80, of all greenhouse gases stem from fossil fuels. In the United States, approximately 4% stems from all livestock. Most other developed countries are the same with respect to overall numbers. So remember, livestock greenhouse gases, particularly livestock methane, is undergoing a cyclical process, whereas fossil fuels are on a one-way street carbon trajectory from the ground up into the atmosphere, accumulating over and over and over again. So now, how does methane differ from, let's say, CO2? Because methane is always converted into CO2 equivalents. I believe that that is erroneous and it needs to change, and many of my colleagues throughout the world agree with me. First of all, how does CO2 behave? Imagine you were to drive to work every day, and imagine you were to drive 10 kilometers or something, okay? So on Monday, you drive to work, you burn gas, you put CO2 to the atmosphere. On Tuesday, you drive the same distance, and then you put CO2 into the atmosphere again. But the CO2 you put in on Monday is still in the atmosphere, and it will stay there for 1,000 years. On Wednesday, you drive again, adding new additional CO2 to the atmosphere, and so on. The whole story goes on and on. You get the gist of it. In other words, CO2 is a stock gas. Every time we burn fossil fuels, we add new carbon to the existing stock. And that's why CO2 has only one trajectory. It goes up over time. So CO2 is a stock gas, but methane is not. Methane is referred to as a flow gas. Methane is not just produced, but methane is also destroyed. If you were to own a feedlot or a ranch or something else with livestock on it, then only the first 10 years of that existence, you would have added new additional methane to the atmosphere. After the first 10 years, because of hydroxyl oxidation of methane, the amount of methane produced and the amount of methane destroyed would have balanced each other out. That's what happens with flow gases. Please know, methane is not like CO2. Methane is not a stock gas. It does not add up to existing stock, but it's a flow gas where new methane replaces old methane that's being destroyed. And is that important? You bet it's important. I showed you the global methane budget early on. If you ignore what I just said, then you act as if the global methane budget will only have sources but no sinks. And that is simply not true. And the reason why I'm explaining this to you is because we are drastically changing the narrative, not just around methane, but around livestock's impact on climate. If you want to know more about this, and I hope you do, please watch the video, but also pay attention to those references that I put at the bottom of my slides. Some of the authors that have recently published on this have put out relatively non-technical blogs, like the first two that you see here. These are colleagues from the University of Oxford, from New Zealand, from other parts of the world, who say that what we do with livestock methane in particular, how we quantify it, is erroneous and must be changed. The people doing this are not in animal agriculture. They are physicists and chemists and so on, atmospheric scientists that don't have those links that some of the critics of animal agriculture always claim people have. You will find not just blogs and white papers being published, but now over a dozen of very high impact journal articles that deal with how we should quantify short-lived climate pollutants such as methane. I will have two slides that are really important. And again, I apologize if I get a little technical, but it's that important. Imagine three different scenarios here, three scenarios for methane. The first scenario is one by which over 30 years on the x-axis, we increase methane by 35%. The second methane scenario is one where we decrease methane by 10%, so a slight decrease of methane. The third one is a scenario by which we decrease methane by 35%, so a strong reduction. What would these three scenarios of an increase, stable, and a decrease methane trajectory, what would they do to the current way we quantify methane using the so-called GWP100 that the world has been using up until recently? All three scenarios, increasing, stable, and decreasing methane, would be predicted using GWP 100 as an increase in CO2 equivalent units, as if methane were to behave the same way as CO2, which, as I just told you, it does not. So these authors from Oxford University developed a new matrix called GWP star, and GWP star is a big deal. It uses GWP 100 as a base, but it looks at how methane changes over time, not just looking at its production, but also at its destruction. Here's what it looks like when you characterize increasing, stable, and decreasing methane using the GWP star matrix. When you increase methane because it's a strong climate pollutant, you do increase warming pretty drastically. We do not want to do that. We do not want to produce more methane, new additional methane, I want to say. So, for example, currently we have 90 million beef cattle in the United States. We don't want to have 120 million because that would be additional methane from those additional, whatever, 30 or so million. But if we keep our 90 million at 90 million, then here is what the scenario will look like. If you keep your methane over 30 years pretty stable or even slightly decrease, then you don't have any additional warming. In fact, you see that the blue line is below the x-axis, meaning there is slight negative warming. Slight negative warming. There's another term for slight negative warming, and that's cooling. But look what happens when you decrease methane by 35%. When you decrease methane by 35%, you introduce strong negative warming, which is cooling. You are actively pulling carbon out of the atmosphere. Now think about what I just said. A decrease of methane from livestock that can be achieved through mitigation, through feed additives, anaerobic digesters, and so on, will lead to a situation where the amount of methane our livestock produces is smaller than the amount of methane that's being destroyed. We are pulling carbon out of the atmosphere, and that has a strong cooling effect, a strong cooling effect. So, really briefly, three more panels here. The first one is rising emissions of two gases, CO2 and methane. Let's say a power plant produces more CO2 because they crank up and they produce more power. versus a feedlot that grows having more cattle or dairy that increases herd sizes. What would an increasing CO2 and an increasing methane scenario do to the warming associated with that CO2 or the warming associated with the methane? The warming associated with that increasing CO2 would go up and exponentially so because it's a stock gas. But look what happens when you linearly increase methane. When you do so, you increase the warming at the same rate. Nothing unexpected here. But look what happens when you have constant emissions, let's say by a power plant or by a cattle herd. When you have constant emissions of both, then the related warming of the constant CO2 source still goes up because it's a stock gas and because every time you put out CO2, you add to the existing stock. But look what happens to constant emissions of methane. Let's say you have a constant dairy population or a constant beef population in a country, then that constant population putting out constant amounts of methane will lead to constant warming associated with that methane that is currently not being considered by most of the inventories in the world, particularly not here in the United States, and it should be. Look what happens when you decrease both CO2 and methane. What happens to warming? Even if you decrease CO2, your warming associated with decreasing CO2 levels still goes up because it's a stock gas. Up until CO2 is at zero, and then the related warming plateaus. But look what happens here when you decrease methane. You immediately have an instantaneous cooling effect when you decrease methane. So the next question you would ask me is that even possible? Do we want that? Can we do that? Can we reduce methane or not? The answer is yes, we can. So here at UC Davis, I've built structures like these, large so-called bovine bubbles into which I put cattle, and then they emit, they belch, and their manure produces gases and so on, and I measure them. I measure them very precisely. I also go onto commercial dairies and feedlots and so on and measure emissions with wind tunnels and flux towers and all different kinds of technologies known to man worth millions of dollars. I have head chambers available, and into those head chambers I put cows, only the heads of cows, of course, and have them belch their little hearts out so that I can know whether or not certain feed additives have an impact on how much they belch and how much we can reduce. And I work very tightly with the different agencies that regulate air quality. Here in California, that's the California Air Resources Board. I work with the federal EPA. I also work globally with the Food and Agriculture Organization, the FAO, and so forth. And what I can tell you is that there is a drastic change in the narrative around livestock. If you don't believe me, go to the New York Times and read the article on methane that they have published just today. Half of the content that they published is a direct effect of what we have put out as part of the CLEAR Center, which I'm the director of, over the last few months, showing the change in narrative. So can a methane scenario be changed? Can we reduce methane? That was the question. In California, we have a new law that mandates a 40% reduction of methane, 40% reduction of methane to be achieved in 10 years from now. When that law first came out, our dairies and feedlots and everybody else just went berserk, thinking, how in the world can we reduce methane by 40%? The legislature did something smart. Instead of using the cane approach of rules and regulations and fines, they went the carrot approach of telling producers, we want you to reduce methane and we will financially incentivize a reduction of methane in a way that it's cost effective for you. So the state of California put in $500 million, that's a $1 billion. And many dairies, for example, put in anaerobic digesters like the one you see here. This is a covered lagoon that's put, where a cover is put on top of a lagoon, where the gases are trapped, and here in particular methane gas. But that gas is not just burned like in the past, but that gas is then converted into vehicle fuel called renewable natural gas, or RNG. If you were a dairy in California doing that, covering your lagoon, trapping the biogas, converting it into fuel, the way I'm showing here, you would be experiencing very large credits, financial credits for doing so. You would get very high payments for that. So turning a liability, such as methane emissions that go into the air, affect the climate, into an asset is something that we are experiencing here now. And not just is this happening on a small scale, since 2015, we have reduced 2.2 million metric tons. 25% of dairy methane has been achieved. A 25% methane reduction has been achieved up until this point. I told you we are asked to have a 40%, so we are over halfway there in just a few years. We will achieve a 40% methane reduction in the state of California from our dairy sector, and that will have a strong cooling effect. Now, how is that for a change of a narrative? I think that not just are we into changing the narrative of dairy, of beef, of other livestock, and their climate impacts, but in my opinion, we will move these sectors into sectors that provide solutions to the climate issues we have at hand. So to me, that is a double whammy, and one that I'm striving for and working for very hard. If you want to follow me on Twitter, which I hope you will, my Twitter handle is GHGGuru. I'm the director of the so-called Clear Center here at UC Davis, and that, of course, is also on Twitter. I'm also having a blog. You see the address here. And whenever the chance arises, I'm very happy to entertain any questions that you might have. Thank you so much for the honor to speaking here today. And I hope that I was not too technical and that I was able to offer some hope and some insight into where we are going on the environmental side. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mittlener. You were very technical, but I was able to understand it. And so if I'm able to understand it, I think just about anybody can understand it. And what a great story. And what a great story of success and of technology helping change the narrative, as you said. I'm going to look for that New York Times piece. My colleague, Ana Marisa, already showed it to me on her technology, her iPhone. So we're going to certainly look at that and see how we can share that message with others. So thank you very much for your presentation. Our next presenter is Dr. Elena Rice. Elena is the Chief Scientific Officer at Genus. Before joining Genus, Dr. Rice spent 18 years at Bayer, where she was responsible for a pipeline spanning seeds, traits, and biological products, among others, across all phases of development and all geographies. She has led the development and introduction of new genetic improvement technologies and has also nurtured a portfolio of gene editing projects. Elena received her degrees in biology from Lobachevsky State University in Nizhny Novgorod and her PhD in plant physiology and biochemistry from the Timirzyayev Institute of Plant Physiology in Moscow. Dr. Rice, we're pleased to have you. The floor is yours.
I hope you all can see my first slide, and
you can.
Hello, everybody, and thank you, Lloyd, very much for this lengthy introduction with difficult Russian names of our institutions. But it's my privilege and honor to talk to you all today about how we can harness technology to improve livestock production, and also how Genus Company is working toward developing new technologies. So innovation in swine, beef, and dairy genetic is critical tool to as a part of our global effort to ensure sustainability of animal protein production. And yet, I would say despite all of the research and advanced science during last several decades, we still have a long way to go to eliminate animal diseases. So given audience in this virtual room, I'm sure we all know this, but it's always good to remind ourselves. Like people, like pets, animals, livestock animals, even under the very best farmer's care, get sick. And I think it's very similar to how we think about our children. Even in the best homes with best parents, our kids also get sick. So the disease impact impacts all types of animals. And I think it's also very important to remember that the diseases, animal diseases don't discriminate. Even if animals raised in barns or outside, and whether it's a production livestock or it's wild animals. So when we think about the impact of animal disease, there is a significant ripple effect. And it's really important when we're thinking about it that the consequences for when animals get sick really share it by all stakeholders in our food chain. This is definitely not only a problem for farmers or for producers. We all pay some price for that. So if you think about animal, obviously it's a suffering in many cases from secondary infections and increasing high mortality rates. For farmers and for producers, first, it's direct impact, it's a loss of animals. And of course, as a result of that, farmers will treat animals to help them to be healthier, and very often those treatments are with more antibiotics. And the cost then is passed on food companies, consumers, and the environment. Well, consumers all want their food supply to be safe, and we are all producers, but we're also consumers. They want the food system to be humane, and they definitely want less antibiotics. But they also need to have affordable choices when they're thinking about their protein. So the food companies, they hear their consumers really well. Yesterday, there was a great presentation from Tyson Company, and it was very clear how seriously they take in what their consumers think about food. And they definitely want to improve sustainability of food production. And of course, we all care about environment. We want to reduce overall waste and prevent disease spread, and which is important because it spreads to all geographies. So do we have today solutions to solve all of these problems, so at least some of them? Well, I think technology and science represent one very important part of this whole scope of solutions. And technology and science have already demonstrated that they can provide significant impact on sustainable animal agriculture. And I think it's very important for all of us to remind ourselves and to recognize how far we moved today in sustainability of animal agriculture. If we compare what we could do 70 years ago, 50 or 20, even 20 years ago, through selective breeding, farmers and later scientists have been able to produce significantly more with much less. So what you see on this slide is our numbers just between 93 and 2013, just like the most reliable source that we have today. And you see those lines that shows the change. And I can assure you that between 2013 and today, which were in 2021, now these lines actually became even steeper and trends continue exactly in the same direction. But if you think about pigs, then compared to 50 years ago, prolificity of pigs increased by 100%. And if you think about just between 1993-2013, meat production increased by 80% per sow, and with significant decrease in feed requirements. So in dairy, we are able to produce 60% more safe milk with 60% less cows compared to 70 years ago. And between 93 and 13, actually we achieve almost 22% increase in milk production per cow in a year. And in beef, when we're talking about feed and gain of in production, those really, again, in this short time period that you see here, we decreased almost by 10% feed necessary to gain 1 kilogram of weight. So I think we always have to reflect on the history and where we are today and how far we already moved in animal agriculture towards sustainability. But the question is that today we know for sure that the development of science and development of new technologies can do a lot more to improve further sustainability of animal production. So today I will very briefly tell you a few words about genus. I will talk about technology innovations and also spend some time on technology acceptance approaches that we believe in at genus. So who is genus? Well, genus is a world leading genetic company, and our business units PIC and ABS focusing on porcine and cattle species. And our R&D platform develops technology across species. Now, we're not consumer facing company, and that might be the reason many people in the audience might not hear our name too often. We are providing genetics to the producers. And for more than 85 years, we've been developing pigs and cows that have desirable traits, improving their productivity, and also with focus on disease resistance. So at genus, our research and development efforts are focused on applying genomic science, new animal breeding techniques, and advanced reproductive biology technologies to overall help our global food system to be healthier. And we combine our research with the power of genetic selection through our proprietary breeding programs in porcine, dairy, and beef. So how we think about animal health in the context of food system sustainability? Well, there is today a clear connection between human, animal, and environmental health. And as we are learning from previous pandemics and during our current COVID-19 experience, the public health, food security are connected, and it is well documented. So globally, governments beginning to focus on One Health approach to really prepare or also detect and mitigate pandemic disease risks and respond to crises through comprehensive human, animal, environmental health infrastructure. In the case of application of new animal breeding technologies, we really convinced that these technologies can provide very promising approaches because they can break the chain of transmission by make animals less susceptible to a variety of viruses. If we can achieve that, animals could live healthier lives, preventing illnesses, unneeded sickness. Farmers could potentially use less medicine and antibiotics, and the livestock will be healthier as a result of food system would be much safer. But let us also not to forget about climate change and effects we already observing and we know about that those changes have on livestock health, well-being, production, and reproduction. And at the end, it is all about accessibility of the animal protein, especially where this protein is needed the most. So today, I really was excited to hear a talk right from Frank about methane, because I think we all recognize that animal agriculture specifically facing a lot of different challenges from society. So we ask to raise animals healthier, reduce carbon footprint, make it more sustainable, reduce antibiotic use, prevent diseases, and eliminate food waste. And we all probably all would agree those are all right direction for us. And the key question is how to get there. There is an urgent request today to bring new technology innovations, because only through such innovation we can achieve more and solve at least some of these problems. So one of the technologies that at Genus we believe has an opportunity to help us address many of the challenges is gene editing. You know, it's really great. It's worked well for my talk, because just a couple of weeks ago, the Nobel Prize in Chemistry was awarded to two brilliant women scientists for the development of a method for genome editing. You know, it's really one of unique situation, actually, because only after a few years, this technology became known. It is now recognized as a technology that can improve human health, crop performance, taste and quality of our vegetables. And definitely, this is the technology that has an ability to accelerate our search for disease cure in animals. So when we're thinking about gene editing, the question is how we think about in a way that allows us to use it responsibly. So we at Genus want to use gene editing to really focus on diseases and eradication of diseases to improve animal lives. And currently we have several disease-related projects in our pipeline. One that is closest to commercialization is porcine reproductive and respiratory syndrome virus-resistant project. And in this example, and I will talk a little bit more specifically about this project. So an example of our porcine-resistant project, we really in a race today against disease from endemic virus that today cannot be effectively prevented or eliminated through all traditional veterinary medicine, including vaccination. It is causes animal death and suffering, as well as the loss of $1 billion in farm production worldwide. But the effect again broader, just like I was talking a few slides back, the effect of this disease really been felt everywhere. It is in consumers because they thinking about death and suffering of animals and the elimination of antibiotics from their food choices, and the food companies because they worry about sustainability and elimination of the waste of antibiotics. And finally, again, it's all going back to the environment. But the interesting thing that this disease was a focus for researchers and scientists for the last 30 years. And scientists looked everywhere to find a way to prevent PRRS and cure it, unfortunately without much success. And actually distribution of PRRS around the globe increased in the last 15 years significantly. So even if pigs survive PRRS, it often suffers from many secondary diseases. And obviously it leads to unnecessary increase of antibiotics on the farm. And again, PRRS, just like any other disease, doesn't discriminate. And it does infect pigs that raised in all different types of production. At 2011, Iowa State University did the research to estimate how much losses actually we have today due to this disease. And only in US pork producers are losing over more than $600 million a year. And if we look at Europe, that figure is much higher. It's over $1 billion of losses every year. So it is a serious disease. Today, we have opportunity to cure it through gene editing. Now, if you ask me how we think about gene editing and what it is and what it is not, I want to stop a little bit, pause on that slide. I want us to recognize that when we're talking about gene editing, there is no addition of DNA from any foreign species. We're also focusing on approaches that allowing us to turn off genes that are specifically interacting with the viruses and creating susceptibility to the disease in the animal body. So the whole approach is focused on making animals healthier, at least from the work that we do in our company. And if I will talk about what gene editing is not, it's definitely not transgenic. There is no foreign DNA transfer in the methods that we're using today. We're also not planning or interested to use gene editing to design animals. And we're also not interested to work on the traits that can allow animals to withstand more harsh treatment or allow for any kind of abuse. And again, and we think about what it is, it's a very powerful technology today that has very significant promise. So while technology itself can help us to make animals healthier, I would say that today, path toward commercialization is not easy. And it's very important to take a holistic approach to bringing the PRRS-resistant pigs, as well as next generation of disease-focused projects to the market. So when we're thinking about holistic approach, to us, it really means that we need to ensure transparency and working proactively with governments, the global food systems, and with consumers. And we have in our work three principles. Our technology choice is focused on animal well-being, and it has to have real farmer benefit as well as sustainability benefit. We are going to be transparent about our efforts, and we are engaging with the value chain and governments globally. We also recognize that how important it is to build trust, given that consumers, packers, producers, retail, they all want to have more information about innovative technologies like gene editing. They want to know what is in and what is not in their foods, and they also want to make sure that the food is safe. So, and we fully understand we can't hide any of the information in any way, and we are not interested in doing so. Our downstream partners and consumers all must feel empowered to make their own choices for their foods. So we also know quite well that what is not going to work is not making all this information transparent. We know that consumers need to have access to good information about gene editing, and they need to believe scientists. That's in our experience, we know it's not always happened fast or easy. And we believe also that that transparency and open communication with all the stakeholders and consumers is very important, talking about what we do about development and commercialization efforts that and how we do it, and that to show that we do it responsibly. Like with any technologies, we really appreciate that we need to have a set of principles to help guide us through the appropriate use of technology to build that trust with the whole food chain and the most importantly with consumers. So I would really want to say that when we're making gene edits, specific gene edit to make animal less susceptible to the virus, and in this case, specifically to PRRS virus, we put in our animals through a lot of testing. That includes all level of molecular testing, but also very importantly, every generations of animals, we're making sure that they carry only desirable traits and none of unexpected ones. So by other words, we are testing our animals to see that they're resistant to PRRS and nothing else. We're also testing to make sure that meat from any animal entering the food system is nutritionally equivalent or even better compared to meat from any other farm animal. And we are seeking FDA approval, and we comply with all of the testing and safety requirements, as well as with requirements of all regulatory bodies around the globe. So if we would be able, which I hope, I'm very hopeful that we would, to commercialize disease-resistant pigs as a result of gene editing, we will implement the system to ensure ongoing monitoring and of gene editing animals. So this is our commitment. But again, we need to think about the results that this amazing technology can give us and opportunities that it provides while we're developing the whole system of the testing, safety measures. I think that to me, one area that is very important, how we all can work together to make sure that those new technologies really get into the market. Because if they won't, we will continue to deal with the same problems using the same methodologies. That's, as we've seen so far, not providing us exact outcome that we are looking for. And as a part of our efforts towards transparency, we as a company, Genus Company, we adopted a series of ethical commitments in our use of gene editing. And it really relates to, again, you can see it on the slide, it relates to transparency of information, regulatory compliance, monitoring for unintended consequences, environmental stewardship, and third-party oversight. So we're also working with broader food value chain and working in the industry as a part of diverse stakeholders groups that are focusing today on the transparency alignment. It's not easy to bring us all to unified view and unified belief, but I think we're making a lot of progress ensuring that we all can align around key actions that are needed. And those key actions really include today partnering comply with all governmental regulations in terms of testing for safety requirements and assurance by independent verifiers, timely notification of what is coming to the market. That is important. That's why we are communicating about all the development stages of our product. And definitely it's a commitment to mitigate any risk across that could arise across supply chain. And finally, it's a mechanism for verification and use of best management practices as we are developing those products. So I hope I gave you a little bit glance on the new technologies that we are all excited about, that we are putting a lot of our investment developing. And we do it because we firmly believe that that part of animal health itself, and breaking that transmission chain where animals just don't get sick, is really very important, not only for animal agriculture, but also for the society, for the One Health approach as we see it today. And I do hope I gave you a little bit assurance that developing such technology really can help us to do a lot more for the animals and accelerate that sustainable animal production significantly more than we even done in last 70, 50, and even 20 years. So thank you all again for opportunity to talk today and for the privilege to be in this meeting.
Thank you, Elena. We're honored to have you. And I think your presentation is very exciting about the future. I think there's a lot of challenges about how we help convey this breakthrough technology of gene editing to consumers. I know that the industry is working very hard on that to not repeat the mistakes that we did with transgenics in the past. And we're hopeful to work with you, with companies like Genus and others to help provide the data and information and transparency for governments so they can deploy the appropriate regulatory environment to enable new technology to get to the marketplace. So we're looking forward to work with you and your company and others like it in order to help do that in the future. Спасибо большое for your presentation.
Thank you.
Our next presenter is Antonio Mario Pence. Dr. Pence is the Global Strategic Accounts Director for Cargill Animal Nutrition. He is another link to the University of California, Davis, in the same panel. As someone who grew up next to UC Davis, I'm thrilled to have a couple Californians, or at least links to California, here today. He received his PhD from UC Davis and has had a career in academia, mainly as a faculty member at the Federal University of Rio Grande do Sul in Brazil. He has held various industry positions as a nutritionist consultant, and among his many recognitions, he is a member of the Latin American Poultry Industry Hall of Fame. So Dr. Pence, we're delighted to have you. The floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Dr. Lloyd, and thank you, Ika. Can you hear me very well?
Perfectly, thank you.
Okay, and also the U.S. Dairy Sport Council for this delight invitation to Cargill. And thanks to my friends to Cargill that gave me this this complex and very important, you know, opportunity to talk about something that we strongly believe and we need to continue strongly working hard on that. I think Dr. Frank and Dr. Elaine helped me a little bit on their perspectives on the way that I will be putting some information on the track. My quick agenda will be an introduction, you know, and then I'll be talking about different technological future and trends and things that we believe at the company and also that the scientists all over the world are looking on that direction. It's important to say that we as an animal producers, we are already efficient because if we are feeding the world in the way that we are doing, we must be efficient. So the question in this seminar is exactly to see and to tell the people not only how efficient we are, and besides that, how much we are working hard to be more efficient and helping and strongly supporting what our Secretary McKinney had said in terms of the sustainability. So my first thing on introduction is to say, sorry about that, I need to put it this way. At the beginning of this century, the relationship in between urban and rural as was 2/3 for urban and 1/3 for rural. And 50 years afterwards, we'll be getting exactly the opposite. We'll have 66% of the population on cities away from the farms, from the production, and 34 will be there to take care of feeding the world. So that situation will move the balance from less producers to more consumers. It means that agriculture activities will need to be more efficient. So we'll have less people to produce to someone else that is away from the farm waiting for the supply of our food. And a very important, and I think very stimulation proposal, especially about, based upon what Dr. Frank had said regarding the greenhouse gas production. If we look what the OECD FAO agriculture says, that we'll be improving the feed production. Let me get to my pointer here that I think will help you guys. So we'll be improving in different regions of the world, we'll be improving the agriculture production And at the same time, we'll be having a reduction on gas emission. So this is the first very important thing to say. That's not just in the United States, on Europe, or Brazil. This is a commitment of the world. Even countries that are in what we will say, developing world, the opportunities are also going very strong to reduce this gas emission. And the urban society, needs to understand the importance of that. One good example for that is in Brazil, where the evolution of the pasture area and the productivity of beef cattle is something very intriguing. You see here in green the reduction of area of beef cattle production. And here you can see the increment of the tons of meat produced in the same condition. So definitely you need to be much more efficient to do 65%, 69% better in a 15% less space. I should say that Cargill has a project called Beef Up, where the proposal is to reduce on their own and client's farm 30% of the gas production or emission based on the numbers of 2017. Sorry, I figured out there is a mistake in this slide. For sure, I'll fix it. And Cargill, based upon all this COVID situation, decided to come with a survey with 2,800 adults pooled in four different countries, United States, Brazil, Vietnam, and Norway, to review the appreciation of the people on the urban area regarding to animal agriculture. And it was very interesting, some insights that came from this survey. I think two of them are very important. Two-thirds of the consumers acknowledge an increased pressure on animal farmers. They really recognize that the society is pushing a lot on the producers. And that's the truth. We are seeing that on a daily basis. Everyone trying to say things that are most of the time not scientifically corrected. And the other point that I think that was very important that came from this survey was that 71% of the consumers expressed concern about the pandemic disruption of the food system. I think this is great because even with all this craziness that came to the world, the producers didn't give up. The producers continue producing whatever the urban society was looking to have. And the urban society was scared about that. Almost 70% was scared to that. And 84% of the consumers indicated they were confident in farmers' ability to feed growing population. In a way that I read this, at the beginning, they were scared. And now that the thing is running for more than 7 months, they got very confident with the producers that they were able to maintain the same strengthness, the same capability to continue producing food for the people of the world. One thing that is very important, you know, that most of you already saw these pictures, but I think it in the context of the discussion is important. 1/10 of the people does not have access to sufficient food to achieve the energy and nutrient demands. But in the other side, 1/3 of the all food produced for human consumption is wasted. So these two maps are very conflicting. If you see the reds on the left and the reds on the right, you can see that those things are not matching. I think this is a very, very thing that we need to be more efficient. And economically speaking, this is a tremendous challenge because some of these people do not have the food because the food do not get there. But when the food gets there, it gets with a price that the person cannot achieve. So this is what the society needs to be discussing strongly from now on. Cargill has a project with Heifer organization to help 100 million people to produce their own chicken and sell the production excess by 2030. This project already started in India, Mexico, and Kenya. So we are trying to bring this kind of situation and to put food to the people in their own small places where they live, because it will be very difficult for some of those societies to really get out of their farms to buy things from outside to feed them inside. And another thing that we need to look, you know, especially on the side of the world that we are, that food price will continue to be an issue, because around 50% of the low-income people, they spend on food. This is not the problem related to the high-income society. So we need to continue to be very effective, very technological, very innovation-minded, to start and to continue pushing down the prices of the feed and food to make this population closer to what the high-income society has available. If we look at this situation, just to reinforce what I'm saying, the developing country is growing in the next years a lot. In the industrialized countries, they will maintain very much stable in these less than coming 50 years. So if we believe what was said before, we need to be struggling, technologically speaking, all the time to find a way to put the feed and food for these developing country people. And if we look at these, I like very much these two graphs, you know, it shows the energy consumption by food group and according to the family income. If you take the red rectangles, this is the amount of the energy that comes from the meat in the world average. It was before in 2019, and there is a small tendency to increase. But when we look at the low-income people, you can see that still there is a fantastic space for the animal protein as energy source. So these are things that we need to really realize. And when we look at the protein, as we look at the energy, the same stuff. The average is giving us more or less around 40 grams in the world, but the low-income people, they are eating less than 20, more or less 15 kilos per capita. When the high-income people, they are eating much more protein than they need for their metabolism needs. So these are things that we need to be looking, because based on that, we can see how much we do have as in space to progress on animal production, especially to help the society that is on the developing side of this picture. Okay, then let's go based upon this introduction. So the introduction was to stimulate how much we still have in front of us to really progress on animal production and bringing to the society more stability on nutrient consumption. So for us, the most important technological thing is related to the training of the people. We cannot think about, you know, rocket science if the local farmers do not understand what we are talking about. Sometimes you can have a very small amount of internal farm manual, best practices, simple way to express to the people how to do and how to use the technology. Or you can go to a more sophisticated technology that the technical guy, when visit the farm, he can use his phone or his tablet to establish how the farm is doing at that specific time. We must remember that the people at the farm are the guys that we need to touch. We do not touch the animals. We touch the guys that touch the animals. So if we do not train the people, we'll not be able to put any more sophisticated technology inside. And I'll try to prove with this table. We work very much at Cargill with data analysis. And this one client in Brazil in poultry production, that we decided to study variables that affect body weight. We put in a very big data bank and we studied that. The first main problem, 43% of the variability, we didn't know the origin. Something was happening and nobody knew what was going on. Just 57% were known variables. And the more intriguing thing, out of these 56%, 58% came from the producers, from their chicken houses, and for the technicians that helped them. So training. The data analysis was able to tell us that if we do not train those guys, we are missing 58% of the improvement of the real result of the farm. Look, genetics training that Dr. Enian was talking about, it's important, but look the difference in between genetics training and producer. And then artificial intelligence is something that is mandatory to reduce production variability. We are talking here in animal production only studying variability. Average do not take us to any place. So when we look at a picture like this, as complex as this, the question that comes is, how to make a better decision in such a complex, interconnected, and variable system, taking graphs Z and Y? It is impossible. Z and Y, we are always playing one variable. But in our business, the connection of the variables are different. Another very important point, from now on, animal production must be customized. Because what I want to my company as net income probably is different than others. And if that's true, all these things will change. So copy-paste production in animal production will not be the case from now on. And let's see this thing just to reinforce our question regarding to artificial intelligence. This is a company in Brazil either on poultry production. It's logged their mouth. This is for 3 years production, adjusted feed conversion. And the red line is the average. Every dot is one house, chicken house. And look the variability in between the chicken houses. When we look the real variability with this average, we have a difference in feed conversion of 0.2 or 200 grams per kilo produced. So remember what Dr. Lane said, genetics are improving to be more uniform. But when I talk about animal production, I need to put two things together, genetics, uniformity, and environment. And environment is everything that's not genetics. And I'll try to challenge you about that, you know. So how to survive with this variability? And I made a very simple calculation. If we improve 1 point of this feed conversion in the total chicken produced last year in the world, just 0.01 reduction or improvement in feed conversion will reduce 1.4 million tons of feed consumed. So we are talking about sustainability. We need to talk about artificial intelligence to study how to reduce this variability, because the genetics background is already good. In poultry, we know that every year we improve around 0.02 feed conversion by genetic strain progress. But we lose 20 points inside of our company. So that's something that we need to really think carefully about that. Another thing that we are working very strongly so far, the feed formulation in all the species, monogastrics or ruminants, we talk about least cost feed formulation. So we talk about ingredient cost, ingredient composition, nutrient requirement, and we make a formula. But that is just the top of the iceberg. To formulate very deeply and to get the most important cost of production or margin of production, we need to interact other issues inside of the model besides just the ingredient information. You need to give, even the, in case of broilers, even the baby chick cost. How we will pay the producer? How is our, my total sale? So this is what we call non-linear feed formulation, and Cargill is working strongly on that. So this is one more reason to say that animal production from now on will be extremely customized, because my mortality in my company can be different than mortality of someone else. Just this change all the perspective. Everything will change based upon that. I'm producing a pig with a 100 kilos and my competitor is producing with 110. How I can copy paste a formula when this is very important in this complex challenge? And we need to be sure that we need to look on nutrition precision or precision nutrition. But to do precision nutrition, we require real-time production. I cannot be all the time looking on my mirror of my car backwards. I need to have models that can simulate what we'll have in the future to really start working on more efficiency. When I do not know things on animal production and animal feed formulation, I work with a big safety margin. If I improve my information, I can reduce safety margin. And we were talking about sustainability. This is an improvement of sustainability. Less consumption, less excretion, less water consumption. But how do I survive? This is almost 5,000 samples of crude soybean analysis in our laboratory in Brazil during the last year, where we have every dot here is a protein level. The average is 46.7. But the question that comes, which one I will be using in my formulation if I just have historical data? How I will do if I have a good soybean meal, but that has a very high antitrypsin in its composition, when we know that the increment of antitrypsin reduces the digestibility of amino acids. If this digestibility reduces, what that means? Reducing in weight gain, in making the feed conversion worse, more excretion, more water consumption to get ready to get out of this nitrogen that must be excreted, and all is related to pollution. So we need to work on the real-time production to be very close to what we want. And to do that, the near technology is mandatory. This is the frame of the, all the technology on near infrared. I remember when I started working with that in late 90s of last year, you know. And you see, today we have robot analysis of near internet, near infrared. And more, well, Cargill is working with the company Asayo that we are developing a near infrared that is the size of a phone that we can go to the pasture at the farm and measure, today already done, the humidity of the pasture. We are working now to measure the fat composition of breeder hens using one equipment that you can put in your packet together with your telephone. Another thing that we are doing based upon in real-time formulation, we call inline near feed formulation. The near is over here. Here is the corn or soybean or whatever is passing through. This is an automatic sample collector. And let's see what we can see here in this picture. The nutritionist is formulating based on standard value, all the way through, based on averages. The near infrared that reads every 20 seconds is generating these yellow dots, hundreds of yellow dots. And automatically, the program takes the moved average of the yellow dots that comes the red points. Can you see that the nutritionist for all these hours, he formulates with less protein? And when something happened, a change of silo, changing of supplier, and the soybean went down, he continued formulating the same level. So if we want to talk about sustainability, those technologies for sure are very much important. Cargill has a program called Cargill Maxineer that maximizes the use of the ingredients. Another thing that we are very much related at the company is the real-time production looking the microbiota. We already know that the microbiota of the poultry changes with the daily life. At the 7 days, they have one specific microbiota that keep moving and changing the species all the way through. So if we know the microbiota that is over there, we can study the ones that are good for the host and the ones that are bad for the host. What kind of ingredient can affect this? What kind of additives can affect this microbiota profile? And this is also real-time production. We have a project that we call Galleon that is studying on real-time this microbiota change inside of the chicken intestine. But also we need to be careful because the farm structure is fundamental, like I said before. 22% was of the producers and 5.7% was the farm. Old chicken farm improved to more sophisticated tunnel houses, to more sophisticated two-floor chicken houses. And maybe in the future, we'll have a chicken house that is energy totally independent. And these are things that are moving very fast. Look over here. If I compare the blue, that's a tunnel chicken house, with a conventional chicken house, we can see that the tunnel, the chickens are produced with an efficiency of around 150 grams feed conversion better. So we cannot expect whatever Dr. Elaine said before with the fantastic genetics that are coming using the same technology that our fathers or grandfathers used before. To finalize, one thing that we are working strongly now is robotization. If you read all the articles that are coming from this, what will come after coronavirus? One of the things that is coming most of the text is robotization. People will have less time to go to the farm. The people will be more scared to be to the farm. There is other risky situations that to go to the farm. So robotization from sophisticated to very simple technologies will be implemented. This one is one technology that we use cameras that we look every cow. And this cow, when the camera is on her, the information is coming, what she's eating, how much is she eating, what is her temperature, the milk production, water consumption, the rumination process individually. So you can be looking through the computer how to do for these animals to have less variability. We have already also a joint venture with a company that we have by camera the weighing of the piglets without touching them, the weighing of the birds without touching them. And also there are alternatives coming to the market like this robot that moves around the chicken farm, measuring temperature, humidity, CO2, even based upon noise, they will be able to collect by noise if the animals are feeling well, quote, or not well. So these things on robotization is something that is coming. Some people say, but that is too expensive. Yes, as computers were expensive 30 years ago, those technological things will improve for sure. And then to get to the end, I have three conclusions that I want to go with you. The society will come stronger on its requirements on sustainability, food safety, and animal welfare. And we need to explain scientifically what to do, what we do. lots of people that do not know what we do are trying to explain to the society what we do. And we need to change a little bit this process. We need to overcome these based upon what was said by my other speakers. You know, we need to be very clear expressing to the society. And I would like to add something else here. We need to touch the young kids, because the young kids are not still that, quote, contaminated by all this discussion. So I think we need to work more on the kids that will like to listen important things that eventually older people will not give too much time as they would. Technological improvement will be able to continue producing animals with better quality and cheaper to a very differentiated market. And cheaper doesn't mean that it must be one price. Cheaper in Europe is completely different of, we say, cheaper in a poor space of my society in Brazil. So what do we talk about cheaper doesn't matter. It's a challenge to put more animal protein on the table of the people in the world. And to finalize, changes on technical paradigms are mandatory. We cannot do more of the same. To really make a big changes, we need to be prepared to get away from the comfort zone. And all of us love comfort zone, but to move to these technological, quote, crazy technologies, we need to be prepared to disrupt our old paradigms. So I thank again ICA and US Dairy Export Council for this opportunity. It was great. I hope that I represented Cargill in the way that my people and my friends expected. And also I hope that I brought to you some things to think and to regurgitate, quote, afterwards. Thank you very much for the opportunity, Dr. Lloyd.
Thank you very much, Mario. It was a fascinating discussion of the future of the poultry sector as well as others. As someone who spent a lot of time going into both laying houses as well as poultry production chicken houses, I can see that Cargill and you are working on the future, and it's quite exciting. And I think your 3 points summed it up very nicely. And especially, how do we make sure that we are getting the appropriate information to consumers as well as to the youth so that we can help influence them? We are running behind time, so I will again ask you if you have questions to utilize your chat function so that we can get those questions answered directly. We're now going to move on to our next panel, which is about socioeconomic development and livestock farming in the Americas. The social and economic importance of livestock production in the Western Hemisphere will be examined in this session. Experts will present both the importance of livestock production to support economic development in rural communities, as well as the role of international trade governed by science-based standards in helping farmers access new markets and produce safe foods. Our first speaker is Rodrigo Lima. Rodrigo is a partner director of Agroicone Limited, a leading organization on key agriculture and renewable energy agendas related to trade, the environment, and sustainable development. He has 16 years of background on international negotiations, such as the World Trade Organization, the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, and the Convention on Biological Diversity, the Cartagena Protocol, among others. He coordinates projects aiming to promote the sustainable development across different agricultural chains, comprising the engagement of producers, industry, banks, NGOs, and public stakeholders based on a continuous approach. Rodrigo, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Dr. Lloyd. It's a pleasure to join this amazing debate that IECA is promoting since yesterday regarding one of the challenging topics that we deal every day related to sustainable development and how to improve sustainable development when we talk about livestock. It's a pleasure to talk a little bit about our work and how we understand livestock is connected to the Sustainable Development Goal 8 that deals with jobs and innovation and how to connect the social part of the sustainability agenda with a specific sector within agriculture, in this case, livestock. I will share my presentation here. Just please confirm that you are seeing the presentation.
We see it, thank you.
Okay, thank you so much. So to start, the role of animal production in rural development and attaining the SDG 8, decent work and economic growth. I start here with two photographs of livestock in different types of pasture, but I think it's quite important when we are talking about how to produce and how to improve or not improve and so on. And I will develop this during the presentation. So to start, this is a brief presentation of the numbers from 2019 of the Brazilian beef agro-industrial system, thinking about how the production of beef itself correlates to the different chains and subsectors along the chain to be able to understand that that livestock production is one thing, then you have all the inputs and services, you have the slaughterhouses, you have the retail and services, you have the total retail revenue and so on. And this is some almost $160 billion in Brazil in 2019. And what is important from this figures here, in my perspective, is that one thing is the producer on the field using genetics and improving production, as we just we were discussing yesterday and today, the ability to improve production and so on the field. The other thing is the industry and how to reduce costs, reduce emissions, and ultimately produce more with less inputs and so on. I think this different stakeholders on the whole chain are important when it comes to jobs and good jobs and how a specific sector impacts on daily lives and job creation and so on. My second, here. This again, the numbers of livestock in Brazil, almost 170 million hectares of pasture, 162 million hectares, 213 million heads, a beef production, 10.49 million carcass weight equivalent and 2.48 million tons of exports, which puts Brazil in a unique position in terms of a producing country, assuring food security for its own population and to generate exports, which is important to supporting food security worldwide. Then we go to when you see the big picture like this, it's important, and then we start to see a lot of it. It's very common to see the whole debate about the livestock uses a lot of land because pasture, there's a high dependency of area, so this is not sustainable in terms of how much natural resources are needed to produce protein and all the debates about reducing meat consumption or stopping eating meat and all the pressures against eating animal protein and to substitute for plant-based hamburgers and so on and milk like we were discussing. And the important thing here is that I would like to highlight is that the evolution of Brazilian livestock must be seen accordingly with the how much land use, how much pasture we need to produce what we produce right now. And this graph is completely clear in terms of reducing the area of pastures. There was almost 200,000 hectares in the past, in the 90s. While productivity is increasing and the more we are able to increase productivity, to produce more in less time, in less land, more area will be used for agriculture, not for livestock. More area will be restored with native vegetation and so on. So the main point here is to highlight that the possibility to increase productivity and reduce the need for pasture and to recover degraded pasture, that is another point I will come back later. It's extremely important when we are thinking about producing, assuring food security and then all the connections with jobs and good lives that I will try to make. Again, just highlighting productivity as a challenging solution. Productivity rose 169% from the 90s to 2019 in Brazil. There's even a huge space to increase even more. It's very safe to say that beef livestock productivity in Brazil has plenty of space to increase, and this relates to several aspects that ultimately are connected to jobs and capacity and knowledge and technical assistance and so on, as I will touch upon later. And having said that, I think it's extremely important to show these numbers because a lot of people think that Brazil are just about monocultures and big farms and so on. And this is interesting because I think we need to have a historic perspective to understand how different countries were colonized and developed over decades and decades to have the agricultural profile in terms of what is the average size of farms in every country. In the south of Brazil, for instance, you have smaller farms. State of Santa Catarina, for example, has, because it's a small state, but has smaller farms. Paraná state, that is my state, has smaller farms, but has some bigger farms. But if you compare a big farm here in the state of Paraná that can have 500 or 1,000 hectares or 2,000 hectares, this is a small farm in the state of Mato Grosso in the center west of Brazil. So what I wanted to highlight here is that we have around 5 million farms in Brazil, and 3.89 million are smaller farms, what we call familiar agriculture. And if you look here on the right side, despite the fact that the biggest number of farms are familiar agriculture, they have 80 million hectares, while the 1.1 million farms that are not familiar agriculture, they have 270 million hectares. This is completely different when you think about what technology are used by those producers. Familiar agriculture or a normal agriculture, how they access credit, or if they access credit, they have technical assistance and they are capable of using new technologies and to improve their production systems in terms of being able to produce more, to contribute more, to have a better life by their work. So I think this is extremely important because there's plenty of room to work when it comes to improving the final productivity of the different agricultural systems in the farms. It's important to highlight that 2.4 million farms has livestock activities. And what to do, what to improve? Is there space for technology for improving sustainability from an environmental and social perspectives? That's the challenge ahead of us. And I think I will prove that it is there. There's a lot of room to improve. And one of the ways, and Horace, when he approached me to invite me to the webinar, we talked about the SDGs and SDG 8 as one of the ways to see all of this debate. And I really like the challenge and appreciate the possibility to be here discussing, because from my perspective and my knowledge, trying to understand the different negotiations from the WTO to the climate change to the biodiversity for us and so on, the FAO and so on. Like I was saying today, there's plenty of criticisms and a lot of people simply arguing that the right way to do, the sustainable way to follow, is to stop eating meat, stop eating animal protein, or simply changing for plant-based and so on. Because otherwise we will not achieve sustainable development. And I really would like to push this argument against some specific issues, because to achieve no poverty, that is SDG 1, we need to have food. I think no one of us can work well, can live well, can sleep well if we're hungry. And to be able to have food, I need to have a work, I need to have access to food, I need to have money to buy, or someone need to give me food, which is not a good option, right? Or I need to have money to buy, and then there must be food to be bought by people, different types of food, and not just a small basket of food, of options. So if we combine SDG 1 and 2, we will be able to talk about good health and well-being. We will be able to talk about people working decently, people, jobs being generated, created, and new technologies being developed when we talk about innovation in SDG 9. And because there's innovation and there's a lot of different techniques and different startups and companies, there are jobs being created connected to the different sectors. In our case, we're talking about livestock. If this machine starts to work, connecting these different sustainable development goals, inequalities will be reduced, right? The less work, the less sectors developing, adopting technology and so on, more inequality we will have. Then we will be able to talk about sustainable cities and communities. Then all of this equation generates a huge debate about what is responsible consumption and production. That is the SDG 12. And there a lot has been said yesterday and a little bit today about what is the environmental part of sustainability when it comes to livestock. And despite all of the criticisms regarding JG's emissions, we saw a great presentation about methane debate when it comes to livestock today. So despite of the criticisms about JG's emissions, about land use, about water use, about whatever possible impact on environment, we need to recognize that we can measure sustainable development just by the environmental side. This is not correct in terms of what is no poverty, what is zero hunger. Again, if you're hungry, you cannot work well. If you have a work to do, right? So of course we need to consider all of those environmental issues, but not simply assuming that if we tackle the environmental, this is done, we have sustainable development. This is not that direct, right? Then we have the climate action and all the GHGs emissions and land use and how to produce more, reducing less resources and so on, and life on land. So I when I was drawing this slide, I choose those SDGs because I see a clear interdependency between them, connected to SDG 8, that is decent work and economic growth. If we don't have SDG 8 taking place and happening more and more and more, I think we cannot talk about the others. So they are all interdependent, and they must be seen together in a transversal manner and not just isolated. Having said that, I think it's important to highlight some things. We did at AgroEconomy, we did a study last year trying to compare the prices, trying to understand how much does it cost to eat the minimum nutritional contents that the World Organization of Health tells people to eat, the World Health Organization, sorry. And we did a comparison in different countries trying to understand how much does it cost to eat the minimum amount of protein that our body needs. And if you eat pork, for instance, comparing prices, it's cheaper than if you will eat only soybean products or corn or chickpeas or peas or lentil, for example. In Brazil, it changes a little bit in the EU, than India, than the US. But the idea here is to highlight that even though the criticism, and I am not advocating that people must eat just animal protein. And just to be clear, I love to eat and to cook, and I eat whatever thing you imagine. But what we wanted to highlight here is that animal protein is important and will continue to be important and will continue to be produced, especially because we are in a very particular moment in our society with all the pandemic and so on. And the world will have almost 10 billion people in 2015. China and India alone, the two countries, will reach 3 billion people in the coming years to 2025, 26, 27. And this is huge, right? So the idea is here is to try to balance the arguments and try to argue in favor of we need to have a basket of different food and options available to everyone, including meat, animal protein, because this will be much more healthier for, of course, everyone can choose what they want to eat if they have this possibility. And so the point here is to argue that animal protein will continue to be important as a solution. And this graph goes in the same way, because it compares the global index of hunger versus the animal protein consumption per capita. And the less animal protein consumption, the higher is the global index of hunger. If you compare Ethiopia and other countries here in the left and with other countries on the right that eats a lot of animal protein. Of course, this has to be with culture, with access. Countries that produce doesn't rely plenty on imports and so on. But again, is to highlight that it is extremely important to consider animal protein. And then if we agree with this, we simply must start to ask ourselves how to improve production and then to generate innovation and so on to be able to get more jobs and economic development. To be able to touch a little bit more in detail about this argument, I will come back to the number of farms in Brazil and the total pasture we have, almost 170 million hectares. And I will highlight the low carbon agriculture plan that Brazil created in just after the Copenhagen Accord in 2009, COP15 of the UNFCCC, where parties agreed to propose voluntary targets to reduce emissions and so on. And Brazil created its climate change policy, and one of the sectorial policies to tackle our compromises in the agricultural sector. And so the ABC plan, as we call here, basically got the technologies we adopt, pasture recovery, no tillage, biological nitrogen fixation, integrated crop livestock, forestry systems that you can combine crops and livestock and livestock and crops and integrate a forest component if it's feasible and so on, commercial forests and animal manure treatment. So the pasture recovery and integrated systems here are highlighted, and what we have up to now is that Brazil implemented, having this plan as a sectorial policy, 10.44 million hectares of pasture already recovered since the beginning of 2010, and integrated crop livestock forestry systems, 5.83 million hectares. The total area we have right now is 12.61. There are new numbers coming almost to be published. And the interesting thing here is that since 2011, when the ABC plan was published, started to incentivize the adoption of technologies and what does it bring? A lot of jobs, a lot of rural assistance and support to producers to improve. We reach more than 40 million hectares of area using the technologies and improving and so on. Of course, there's the carbon sequestration that this implies, but there's more importantly than the carbon sequestration is the adaptation benefits that the technology generates and how much more food is produced, reducing impacts, reducing time, and this creates what we call the low carbon agriculture culture in Brazil. And it's very possible to say that now the ABC plan and or policy in Brazil is something that everybody knows, and including the Ministry of Agriculture right now is reviewing the policy to create the next phase from 2021 to 2030 connected to the NDCs, the Paris Agreement, and so on. And I'll come back on this. But then comes the deforestation rates. I believe Fernando yesterday, Fernando Sampaio from PCI Mato Grosso mentioned this. And what I wanted to stress here is that despite deforestation is increasing, it's very simple and not correct to say, you know, deforestation is increasing right now. This is all about agriculture expansion. And that's why the EU-Mercosur agreement cannot be ratified by the European countries and so on. But I think this is too simplistic, because it's extremely important to understand where deforestation takes place when we are talking about land use categories. Because here we see in this graph that private areas represent an average of 30-32% of deforestation in the Amazon. Then there's rural settlements. Brazil has 80 million hectares of rural settlements that was created in the past that are small agriculture. And there's a huge liability that were created by the past governments, because the distribution of lands to small farmers doesn't imply that they are able to produce with technology, with innovation, getting access to credit, to be able to produce in a good manner, to be able to make money from their work and so on. So the graph shows that non-designated areas, which is huge because we have 64 million hectares of the Amazon, are areas that are non-designated, are public lands that the states and the federal government owns, but they don't manage those areas in a specific policy. And so ultimately, what I wanted to show with this graph, connected to the other graph, that is the total amount of deforestation in the Amazon, is that there's no single solution to tackle deforestation. And when it comes to rural settlements and private areas, there's legal and illegal deforestation. And more importantly, what solutions are available to be able to support small producers to not deforestate and to implement technologies to produce more and to be able to produce and conserve native vegetation? Because if we assume that simply producers will not, there's a very common argument that Brazil cannot cut a single tree to expand production. This is true. But when you go to the 64 million hectares of public land that are not designated, when you go to the 88 million hectares of rural settlements that doesn't have technology, not all of the area, but most of the area relies on support from the government on technology and innovation and credit and so on. How to work with those producers to be able to make them produce more and diversify their production and so on? There's plenty of space to work there, and then to reduce deforestation as a co-benefit and generating jobs and economic growth that are the key SDG that I'm supposed to bring to the table. So to be able to advance, I think we need to have in mind the FAO principles of what is sustainable agriculture. That is to improve efficiency in the use of resources, conserve, protect, and improve natural resources, protect and improve rural livelihoods, equity and social welfare, increase the resilience of people, communities and ecosystems, develop responsible and effective governance mechanisms. It looks like there are five straight principles, but if you start to read and to open each of these principles, there's plenty of things and challenges to be tackled here in every country, not just in Brazil, in every country. So I think it is extremely important when we are talking about SDG 8 and its interdependence with the other SDGs, as I am arguing, to look to these principles here and how to create projects, how to improve, how to have public policies, private projects and partnerships that are created to tackle these challenges of producing more sustainably. I don't want you to read this here, but it's defining low carbon agriculture or sustainable agriculture when we have these FAO principles relies on several factors: soil management and improvements, of course. If we can restore degraded pasture, the more we can restore, the better outputs will be generated. GHGs emissions, technical assistance, nature of vegetation conservation, that is a very important thing here in Brazil, considering all the forest code and the conservation obligations for producers. The whole issue around mitigation, adaptation, and resilience. Fortunately, the concept of climate smart agriculture does not have a focus only on mitigation, as it was in the past. Right now, adaptation and resilience brings a lot of pressure and challenges connected to each country and region necessity and capabilities. The different agricultural systems and good practices that can be adopted, because I tend to believe that every agricultural system can improve. Every, no matter if it's organic, agroforestry, monocultures, and so on. Biodiversity, gender issues, technology gaps, land tenure issues, productivity gains, sustainable intensification, food, energy, and security, and subsidies. Subsidies, I think, are important when it comes to qualify what is sustainable or not, because the country that has the capability to give a lot of subsidies has a very peculiar position comparing to the other countries that are most of the world, right? When it comes to the common agricultural policy in the European Union, for instance, it's a unique position. Farmers in the EU are much more well positioned to adopt certain practices and so on because they got subsidies, which is completely different from the most part of the world. So I think subsidies are also an important issue to be present here when it comes to define what is low carbon or sustainable agriculture. And then I would like to bring the Brazilian NDC at the Paris Agreement when it comes to land use and agriculture, because I think 145 countries took actions related to agriculture at their NDC at the Paris Agreement. This shows what? That countries need to improve production in a way that will reduce emissions and, more importantly, adapt their systems, their productive systems, towards the impacts of climate change, because they need this to develop as countries, as societies. And then there's all the SDG 8 background attached to this. And when it comes to Brazil, what what our country took to the Paris Agreement, it's a target of 37% reduction, absolute target to reduce 37% of emissions up to 2025 and 43% up to 2030. And to do that, what Brazil took as possible actions to cut illegal deforestation to zero in the Amazon by 2030. And we need to have in mind that graph that I presented about land use categories, not just the total number of deforestation, because I think this is a simplistic manner to understand the problem. The full implementation of the forest code, because it talks about, it implies conservation of native vegetation. And we are talking about more than 100 million hectares of natural vegetation conserved by farmers. And also restoration, because there are farmers that need to comply with the obligations and they will need to restore. So there's this target to restore 12 million hectares of forests. Compensate emissions from legal deforestation, yes, because legal deforestation is permitted for those who already comply with the conservation requirements. Promote sustainable forest management, restore 15 million hectares of degraded pasture, and encourage 5 million hectares of integration of livestock agriculture and forests, and to do biofuels. Continue to improve biofuels production to achieve 80% of the consumption of biofuels in 2030 in the energy matrix. Today it's almost 18%. So it looks like we already accomplished that we proposed the targets that we already accomplished, but the target is must be calculated with the consumption in 2030 that is expected to be much more higher than it is right now. And when we see this, again, I will come to pasture degradations. And I would like to ask you, this is a liability or an asset that we have? Every country has degraded soil, every country. Degraded soil must be seen as a liability or an asset. If the approach is to cut down forests, native vegetation, to produce, to degrade, and then to abandon soil, and then go search for more land, we are in trouble, right? Right. So in my perspective, pasture, the degraded pasture is an asset that must be used in a wisely manner, because we will because the possibility to restore production in this degraded area talks about carbon balance, relates to jobs, to income generation, to food being produced, to renewable energy being produced, to fiber being produced, to natural vegetation being planted in the soil that is degraded. And this relates to me to the concept of circular economy, because we are approaching, we are transforming a land that is degraded into productive land again. And there are some figures here on the right side estimating that the degradation of pastures generated losses equivalent to R$7 produced due to the expenses with reforming pastures. And this can reach almost R$15, which reduces the revenues of producer that require more time to finish the animals. If a producer takes 4 years to finish an animal, he's not making profit of his activity right now, right? We need to improve pasture. We need to improve we need to improve the management of pastures, to rotate animals in a farm, to be able to allow pasture to recover. And this is about cycle, this is about technology, this is about capacity building, to be able to really reduce the amount of degraded area, increase the amount of food produced with less carbon, and how this relates to all the SDGs, including SDG 8. I think it's very easy to understand that the more area is brought to productive area, again, using technology and finishing animals with 18 months, for example, or 2 years, or 24 months, we will be talking about producing carbon meat with less carbon and so on, benefiting the whole concept of what is sustainable agriculture. And then I'm almost finishing, and then I know that we will hear all the sanitary issues surrounding our debate in a few minutes, but I would like to bring this view about the three S surrounding livestock worldwide, food security, food safety, and sustainable development. Why the three S? In Portuguese is more direct, because, you know, food security, SDG 2 is totally clear, and there's all the food losses that must be tackled. That is also a huge problem that I'm not supposed to mention here, but it's a huge problem. But without a pandemic moment and all the concerns, here in Brazil, there's plenty of arguments saying, you know, besides the GHG's emissions, livestock is responsible for deforestation, and deforestation will generate new pandemics. This is, in my perspective, extremely simplistic way to package an argument against the sector. And again, we will reach almost 10 billion people. Just India and China, 3 billion people. So I think we must be able to produce sustainability would be the ability to produce more with less impact in less time, using all the genetics and the gene editing presentation we saw before I started to speak in a coherent manner. So if we combine food security and then food safety, wet markets are a horrible picture that we must try to tackle worldwide, and generates and creates a lot of impact when it comes to food safety, and then to be able to talk about sustainable development. This photograph here is from a farm in the state of Paraná, and they do this integration of crop, livestock, and forests. And there's the native vegetation there that producers are obliged to conserve and so on. If we combine those three challenges, we will be able to tackle what is sustainable development. And to finish, I think I have some thoughts here just to finish about innovation and jobs towards promoting sustainable development in livestock production. Special recovery and management are essential to enhance productivity, and we need jobs to do that. We need capacity and knowledge to do that. Livestock intensification is also key. Native vegetation conservation on farms, adoption of good practices and animal welfare practices, integration of crop, livestock, and forest. Innovation at the farm level requires technical assistance and rural extension. Innovation requires access to credit and innovative financial mechanisms. And here we are talking about economic development. We are talking about jobs. We are talking about indirect jobs connected to a specific sectors. We have 145 parties considering agriculture at their NDC at the Paris Agreement. What this has about with SDG 8 and the other SDGs that I'm putting together? Promote sustainable production on a continuous improvement basis. It's a trigger to support the SDGs, and support small scale producers is fundamentally important to avoid verticalization and other social issues. Thank you so much for your attention. And it's a pleasure to bring some thoughts to the debate. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rodrigo. I found your slide with about the SDG interdependency very important. And the notion of SDG 8, decent work and economic growth, which is the subject, is highly important. And you know, coming here from the House of Agriculture, it all starts on a farm. You need to be able to produce food in order to produce jobs, in order to eat, to have zero hunger, as is called for in SDG 2. So thank you very much for your presentation. There's a lot of challenges about food production in your country, Brazil, as well as the whole world. But trade is an important component of that. Brazil is a huge trading country. The United States is a huge trading country. The whole world trades. How do we trade in a rules-based way so that we can take, you know, the excess of supply in one region and the productive capabilities in one region and share it with the rest of the world? You talked a bit about subsidies. Well, in California, they're giving subsidies for methane reduction in that state for their farmers. But currently, there's a lot of demands in the world from the climate accords in Paris, as well as other policies that are being implemented around the world that are saying how Brazil ought to be producing, or California or Mexico or other places. And so having a rules-based system is very important. And that's why we invited our next speaker, Aneke Hamilton, to present to us. Aneke is an economic affairs officer in the Agriculture and Commodities Division of the World Trade Organization, where she works in the unit covering the agreement on the application of sanitary and phytosanitary measures. Ms. Hamilton is responsible for supporting the work of the SPS committee, as well as the coordination, organization, and delivery of SPS-related technical assistance activities to WTO members and observers. Prior to joining the WTO, Ms. Hamilton worked at several organizations, including our partners at the Office of Trade Negotiations of the CARICOM and the World Bank. Ms. Hamilton, we're delighted to have you. The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you so much. Good afternoon. I'm assuming that you're hearing me fine and that you're seeing my PowerPoint.
Perfect, thank you.
Okay, great. Let me first start off by extending my sincere appreciation to AICA and to the US Dairy Export Council for organizing this webinar and also for extending an invitation for my participation. So in the presentation today, what I'd like to do is to specifically look at the framework for international standards and its importance in trade and animal products, trading animal and animal products. And with that, we will look at the relevant bodies, WTO, Codex, and OIE. So in terms of a quick outline, I'll first start off by looking at the value of trade in animals and animal products, so showing some statistics. I'll then look at the role and importance of international standards in trade and drill down a bit, looking at the role of some relevant bodies, as mentioned, WTO, Codex, and OIE. I'll focus for a bit on one of the WTO agreements, which is the agreement on the application of sanitary and phytosanitary measures, because that agreement is quite relevant for trade in animals and animal products. And so we'll look at some of the core principles there. I'll then look at notifications and specific trade concerns that have been raised within the context of the WTO related to live animals and animal products. And then I'll finish off with some key takeaways. So looking at the data, we see that the value of annual trade in agricultural products almost tripled over the past decade. And this has largely been in emerging economies and developing countries. Specifically, if we look at 2018, we see that the value of agricultural products traded accounted for just about over US $1,800 billion, of which food accounted for the majority. If we drill down a bit and look more specifically at trade in live animals and animal products, also for the same time period, we see that quite significant values of trade have occurred in terms of meat and edible meat offal, US $128 billion, for dairy produce and birds eggs, $87 billion, and also for live animals, $23 billion worth. Now, in looking at international trade in animals and animal products, or more generally, agricultural products, it's not only useful to look at the value, but it's also useful to look more broadly at what else has been taking place in the international trade arena. And so in that regard, when we look at the past two decades, we can see that there has been a reduction in tariffs through various trade agreements. And this is not only at the global level, but it also has occurred at the regional level. And this has provided greater opportunities for the expansion of global food trade. It has created new markets. But one of the things that one has to bear in mind is that to trade internationally and to access markets, producers must be able to meet food and animal health regulations. They must be able to meet international standards. So that takes us to the core of the presentation today, the interplay between trade and international standards. I would say it's hard to think about trade in food, livestock, and animal products without mentioning international standards. You could say that the two go hand in hand in ensuring safe, nutritious, and sufficient food for a growing world population. On one hand, you have governments that want to ensure that food is safe, that it meets quality and labeling requirements. And to that end, they apply food standards, they develop and establish regulations. And then on the other hand, you have consumers, the end users, who want to have confidence and assurance that the products that they eat, that it's safe, it's of a high quality, and it's authentic. And international standards give that confidence. Let us look now more specifically at the importance of international standards in trade. If you consider the potential large differences between national requirements and specifications in various countries, you realize that this can make trade difficult and costly when you're trying to move goods across various borders. And so in this regard, international standards allow for a common understanding of food safety and animal health requirements. It lessens the need for producers to comply with different standards in different markets. It facilitates producers to be able to access these markets. And when international standards are used as a basis for import requirements, it helps reduce trade costs by making trade more transparent and efficient, thereby allowing products to move more smoothly between markets. Another important point here is the role of science, that international standards provide a sound scientific and technical basis for measures. We'll soon look at some of the standard setting bodies, but just to highlight here that they each have processes to ensure that the standards that are developed are based on science and do go through a rigorous process. So these types of measures help governments to be able to achieve their policy objectives related to food and animal health. And lastly, international standards also assist governments in developing science-based SBS measures. And this can be particularly important for those governments who may have resource constraints as it relates to developing their own food safety and animal health requirements. So in this regard, they can rely on the best available scientific knowledge as embodied in international standards. So what is the role of the WTO, the World Trade Organization, in this interplay between trade and international standards? Well, firstly, as a reminder, the WTO is the international organization dealing with the rules of trade between nations. There are various agreements covering several topics, and these are all negotiated and signed by members who then subsequently ratify these agreements in their parliaments. On a whole, these agreements require good reasons for restricting trade. They aim to make trade stable, predictable, and transparent. And where it is that there are differences of opinion between trading partners, it provides a court for legal disputes. Now, as I mentioned, there are various WTO agreements, but one of which is most relevant to the discussion today on trade in animals and animal products is the SBS agreement. And this provides governments with the means to establish a framework to facilitate trade on the basis of internationally agreed standards for food safety and animal health. So if we look a bit more specifically at the SBS agreement, I'll refer to it as the SBS agreement, short for Agreement on the Application of Sanitary and Phytosanitary Measures. We see here that it sets out the basic rules for food safety, animal and plant health measures in trade. Importantly, in its provisions, it seeks to ensure that these measures, any measures taken for the objective of trying to ensure food safety, animal and plant health, that these measures do not act as unnecessary barriers to trade. Now, the agreement allows countries to set their own standards, but it clearly highlights that regulations must be based on science. So when a government is taking a food safety, animal health, or animal health related measure, they must ensure that it has a scientific underpinning. In addition, the SPS agreement provides a framework to guide the development, adoption, and enforcement of SPS measures. I'll soon highlight a few more core principles of the SPS agreement, but just to encapsulate that, on one hand, the agreement tries to ensure that governments can protect human, animal, plant life or health. They can achieve those types of objectives, but at the same time, ensuring that in achieving those objectives, they are not introducing unnecessary barriers to trade. So what is the link between the WTO SPS agreement and Codex and OIE? We see that the WTO SPS agreement works in tandem with several international standard setting bodies, three in particular. It works with the Codex Alimentarius, which is responsible for establishing science-based food standards. And the SPS agreement specifically recognizes Codex standards as the benchmark, the international benchmark for standards in the food safety area. Also, in relation to animal health, we have the World Organization for Animal Health, OIE, which establishes science-based standards and in the animal health area. And similarly, the SPS agreement recognizes OIE standards as the benchmark. One other standard setting body, which I'll not focus on too much, is in the plant health area, the International Plant Protection Convention, just because of the focus of this webinar. So if we drill down a bit more as it relates to core principles of the agreement, and this is important because the whole purpose, as I mentioned before, of the agreement is that it sets out the rules for trade as it relates to food safety regulations and animal health regulations. So firstly, one of the core principles is that regulations should not be applied in an arbitrary or discriminatory manner amongst trading partners. One of the things that we say is that the SPS agreement has at its core science, so that any measures that are taken should be based on science. And I'll come back to that. Another principle is the recognition of equivalence, that bearing in mind that sometimes there are different production methods or treatments which can be considered equivalent to the import requirements of a trading partner. The principle of regionalization looks at the possibility of allowing trade from disease-free areas. We also have transparency, and interestingly, one of the previous presenters mentioned the importance of transparency and open communication. And that's also important here because it alerts trading partners to any proposed new measures or changes to existing measures. And I'll say a little bit more about transparency in the next couple of slides. The SPS agreement also recognizes the importance of technical assistance and encourages governments to provide this technical assistance, as well as to provide special and differential treatment to developing countries. And lastly, it sets out a framework for control, inspection, and approval procedures. So as that relates to procedures to check and ensure the fulfillment of SPS measures. Now, I highlighted in blue two of the principles, scientific justification and transparency, because I wanted to develop these two principles a bit more. So as mentioned, any animal health or food safety related measure should be based on scientific principles. The agreement strongly encourages governments to harmonize their requirements on the basis of international standards, as this provides a scientific basis for national measures. And as mentioned, the two relevant organizations or bodies that are recognized are Codex for Food Safety, as well as OIE for Animal Health. The agreement also recognizes that in some cases, governments may need to put in place a higher level of protection than that embodied in the international standard. And if that's the case, then the measures should be based on a risk assessment. So basically underscoring that if international standards are not used, there still must be a scientific justification for putting in place animal health or food safety related measures. And importantly, when undertaking a risk assessment, it should be appropriate to the circumstances of the risks being evaluated. And governments should take into account the risk assessment techniques developed by Codex and OIE. The last thing I'll mention on the scientific justification principle is that animal health or food safety related measures must only be applied only to the extent necessary to protect human or animal life or health. They should not be maintained without sufficient scientific evidence, and they should be the least trade restrictive and consistent. Now, one of the important things to highlight is that the agreement recognizes that there may be certain situations, emergency situations, which require measures to be put in place, where it is that there might be insufficient scientific evidence at the time. In those cases, what is indicated is that the measure should be temporary, that governments have the obligation to obtain additional information, and that this measure should be reviewed within a reasonable period of time. So those are the additional requirements in terms of putting in place a measure where it is that there is insufficient scientific evidence. The other principle that I wanted to speak a bit about, more about, was transparency, the importance of transparency in developing and applying animal health and food safety regulations. Now, if you bear in mind that regulatory changes affect market access, so if different requirements are put in place or if a certain requirement has been changed, then it is important for trading partners and other government producers to be made aware of these changes, because ultimately this will affect their ability to be able to access the markets of their trading partners. So in this way, transparency enhances clarity and predictability in the trading system. It gives an opportunity for advance warnings, and as well as it improves accountability and responsiveness of the regulatory system. Through that process, governments have certain obligations under the SPS agreement. Firstly, that they should notify draft SPS regulations. So where there is a new or revised animal health or food safety related measure which impacts trade, this should be notified to the WTO, and there's a procedure for that. Importantly, this impact on trade could be trade restricting. So whether or not it is that restrictions or requirements are put in place. But in addition, where it is that these requirements have been lifted, where it is that it's trade facilitating, this should also be notified. In most cases, governments remember about trade restricting measures, about notifying trade restricting, but not necessarily always remembering to notify trade facilitating measures. And in that regard, there is a national notification authority which is designated to carry out this particular role. If at any point in time a government has any queries about a particular measure or regulation that's in place, they can contact the national inquiry point. So there's an obligation to establish a national inquiry point, which is the first point of contact to ask for information on measures, to request a risk assessment, or to pose any other such related questions. And then lastly, as it relates to transparency, a key component is the publication of regulations. Where can these regulations be found? If a trading partner wants to actually see the text of the requirements, where can they find this information? So, still on notifications, I thought it might be useful just to show a few statistics here. On the left side of the screen, you see that SPS-related notifications between 1995 to the end of June accounted for just over 26,000 notifications. And of that total sets of notifications, those related to live animals and animal products accounted for about 25%. Now, with this pie chart, it shows you a difference between 2009 and 2019, a 10-year span, where highlighted in yellow, we see that 16% of notifications were related to animals and animal products which reference codex or OIE standards. This was in 2009. In 2019, this increased a bit to 19%. So showing that there is a growing number of notifications that are referencing codex and OIE standards. One of the other things I wanted to highlight is specific trade concerns and how it is that this impacts on discussions on food-related and animal health-related measures. First of all, it is critical that governments are able to have an arena to discuss food-related and animal health-related measures, but also to be able to air any particular concerns that they may have. And the SPS committee is such a forum where members can raise any issues that may be related to these types of measures. We see that in all, between the same period from 1995 to the end of June 2020, 486 SPS-related trade concerns were raised. And if we look in the pie chart on the left-hand side for 2009, we see 47% of those trade concerns that were raised were related to animals and animal products, and they specifically referenced codex or OIE standards. On the right-hand side, we see 10 years later that only 38% of those SDCs reference codex or OIE standards. In this slide, we see some examples of trade concerns that have been raised related to animals and animal products, and some of these issues have been discussed in earlier sessions. Highly pathogenic avian influenza, BSE, veterinary drug MRLs, foot and mouth disease, African swine fever, a more general trade concern as it relates to delays in approval procedures for meat and dairy products, and more recently, due to the pandemic, concerns related to COVID-19 related restrictions. So what are some of the key takeaways as we look at trade and international standards? First of all, that international standards allow for a common understanding of requirements, which facilitates smooth trade and enables access to international markets. A reminder that the WTO SPS agreement strongly encourages governments to harmonize their requirements on the basis of international standards, which provide a scientific basis for national measures. As mentioned, Codex and OIE standards are seen as a reference point for food safety and animal health, and in this regard, they are essential. And the last point here, which focuses more on the work of international standard setting bodies, is that there needs to be effective coordination between domestic stakeholders, as well as participation of governments in the work of international standard setting bodies like Codex and OIE, in order to ensure that standards take into account the realities and address the needs of different countries, as well as to ensure that they're up to date and relevant. So with that, I bring my presentation to a close. Just to highlight that once the presentation is up, there are some useful resources, web links, that could be of interest to you. So with that, I thank you and hand back over to the chair.
Thank you, Annika, and thank you for the work you do at the WTO. We at AICA work very closely with the WTO SDS Committee, with Codex, with the IPPC, the OIE, the Cartagena Protocol, all those groups in order to help our governments work with you all, and so that we work together in order to ensure a smooth flow of trade in not just animal products, but all agricultural products. Being someone who kind of cut his teeth on the BSE situation at the USDA, the work that you do and the importance of international standards and science-based standards is critical for agriculture, for agricultural economic development, and for farmers and ranchers everywhere. So thank you very much for what you do. The last session today deals with looking at strategies and tools for the livestock sector to understand and enhance trust with consumers. At a time when consumers' concerns about livestock production is often stoked by organizations that advocate a plant-only diet, it is essential that livestock producers focus on connecting with consumers. Our next speaker is Charlie Arnott. Charlie is a recognized thought leader in food and agriculture. He is highly regarded as both a writer and sought-after speaker who engages audiences across the globe. Charlie has more than 25 years of experience working in communications, public relations, and issues management within the food system. He is the founder and president of Look East, an employee-owned consulting firm, and he also serves as a CEO for the Center of Food Integrity, an international nonprofit organization dedicated to building consumer trust and confidence in today's food system. As someone who used to be very involved with the checkoff programs, Charlie, I am convinced that there is an opportunity to connect with consumers in a very powerful way. And what this industry needs, not just in animal agriculture, but in all of agriculture, is how do we build trust between the farmers and their customers and help people understand where their food comes from. We've heard a lot of information over the past 2 days about science, about the environment, about new technologies that are going to help us do incredible things with food production, with food safety, with restoring the environment. That's a lot of information. Some of it's very technical. How do we put it together in a way that consumers around the world can understand and help advance our cause to help create more jobs in agriculture, more technology coming into agriculture, and a cleaner environment? So for that, we're going to look to you to tie this all up together in a way that we can maybe learn from you and all of us figure out ways to communicate what we do in a better way. So Charlie, over to you.
Great, Lloyd. Thank you for that. I appreciate the opportunity very much and appreciate everyone's attention this afternoon and look forward to sharing a bit more information with you. As Lloyd mentioned, our goal here is to really help us better understand how can we take all of the knowledge we have, all the information we have, and make it more relevant and more impactful as we engage in these conversations, knowing that we need to be able to increase productivity, we need to be able to use technology, and that those things bring significant benefits to society in general and to consumers specifically and to farmers as well. So with that, let me give you just a little bit of background about CFI. Here's our agenda for the day. I'll cover who CFI is, talk about some evolving stakeholder priorities and how things are beginning to change and shift. And that's important to us to understand as we think about how we want to move forward and develop our messaging and our strategies for engaging. What we know about building trust, we have a peer-reviewed and published model for what it takes to build trust. I'm also going to share with you how we missed one strategic pivot. And I'm hoping that we can use that as a case study to think about how we can improve going forward and then talk about some effective future strategies. So that's kind of the lineup for our conversation today, and I look forward to sharing the information and then answering your questions and engaging in conversation when we finish. The Center for Food Integrity, as was mentioned, is an international nonprofit organization with a single mission, and that's to help today's food system earn consumer trust. We would argue that trust is the most valuable and intangible asset of any organization, and that being able to earn and maintain consumer trust is absolutely essential to the business success for any company. You can see kind of the diversity of the types of organizations and companies that are part of the Center for Food Integrity, and having that diversity of members really helps us look at things from a 360-degree view, because we have suppliers, we have farmers, we have retailers, we have food processors, we have civil society all represented as members, and you can see that reflected in our executive committee and our board of directors. We have Costco, a large global retailer, FMI, the Trade Association for Retailers, Dairy Farmers of America, the Pork Checkoff, Chick-fil-A, the State Soybean Checkoff Organization, and Gina, she heard from Elena earlier today, and one of her colleagues, Ernst van Urso, serves on our executive committee. And then you can see other brands and organizations, companies that serve on our board, including Cargill, who you heard from earlier today as well. So that diversity of members and participants really helps us look at issues from a variety of perspectives, and we think that's very helpful in our strategies. We focus on building trust. So let's talk a little bit about evolving stakeholder priorities. And a number of speakers today have talked about the focus on increasing productivity and efficiency and throughput. And that's really been the primary focus of agriculture over the last 40 plus years. How are we going to increase productivity? How are we going to increase efficiency? How are we going to increase throughput? What we're seeing today is a fundamental shift in stakeholder priorities. Not that we shouldn't continue to focus on efficiency, productivity, and throughput, but that other attributes should receive equal attention. Things like sustainability, ethical treatment of animals, food safety, nutrition, those should also receive equal attention to increasing productivity, efficiency, and throughput. BlackRock, which is one of the largest capital suppliers to all companies across the globe, Larry Fink, their chairman, sent a letter earlier this year to companies to whom they supply capital, as well as to those who invest in BlackRock. And you'll note there in bold, companies and countries that champion transparency and demonstrate their responsiveness to stakeholders will attract investment more effectively, including higher quality and more patient capital. McKinsey released a report earlier this year on the ESG premium, New Perspectives on Values and Performance. Now, ESG, environmental, social, and governance, is kind of the marriage of sustainability and corporate social responsibility. It's kind of all of that wrapped into one attribute where we're beginning to see a much greater focus on those attributes, which again, include things beyond metrics or productivity metrics. As McKinsey said in their report, ESG issues can affect company performance, and the financial impact of ESG programs is likely to increase as expectations and scrutiny from investors, consumers, employees, and other stakeholders continue to grow. I will share with you, there's one company with whom we're working today in the restaurant business, in the quick service restaurant business. They know that sustainability is not a driver for customer purchase, but they also know it's a key driver for them being able to recruit and retain employees. So there are a number of different ways to think about these issues, where historically we focused on whether or not these are demands for consumer purchase. What we're seeing today is that there are demands for investment, there are demands for attracting and retaining employees, and for earning that social license that we're going to spend more time talking about. So before 2000, we really saw people think about these issues very disparately. I've got my financial goals or my productivity goals, and then I've got my environmental, social, governance goals, or what we may have called at that time sustainability or CSR goals. But there's a slight overlap between the two, but they really aren't connected. Today, that's not the case. Today, they are one and the same. Those who are investing in you, those who are stakeholders of your companies, whether they be employees or others, are demanding that we now think about ESG goals in addition to and at an equal level with our financial goals. And so there's a different expectation. The priorities have continued to shift, and particularly as we've gone through the pandemic globally, people are asking more questions about whether or not attributes beyond productivity and efficiency should receive greater focus. So we're seeing that from other stakeholders, but what is actually changing? What is driving consumer purchasing today? Well, today more than ever, we're seeing consumers buy and vote with their money. They're deciding based on their values and their preferences what they should purchase. And they're integrating attributes like sustainability, social responsibility, in a way they never have before. And that's particularly true for younger consumers who are more purpose or values driven. We're seeing more consumption of plants, more plant-forward diets. Now, are plant-based proteins going to replace animal-based proteins? Absolutely not. But here's the key takeaway. The interest in plant-based proteins is a signal to those of us in the animal protein sector. It tells us that what consumers are looking for are products that they can feel good about, products that they believe are better for them and better for the planet. So whether it's using research from Dr. Mittlener or other resources, how do we help people understand that they can continue to enjoy the nutrient-dense, simple ingredient products from animal proteins and give them permission to believe that those products are good for them and good for the planet? Consumers are clearly demanding more transparency. You've heard that referenced in other presentations as well, where transparency is a basic expectation today. It used to get a premium, but today it does not. Those companies who are not transparent actually are discounted. Clearly, the greater focus on environmental sustainability as we're dealing with climate change and the impacts of climate change. What's the impact of animal agriculture on that? What is our contribution? And more importantly, what are we doing to manage that contribution? The implication or the relationship really between diet and health. We also know that during COVID and post-COVID, there's an increased interest in immune health. And what does it mean, diet and immune health? So it's a great opportunity again for those in the animal protein sector to step into that conversation and to begin to reinforce the value that animal protein brings to diet and health. And then of course, the ethical treatment of animals, animal well-being continues to be a driver. But we see these six different factors now beginning to change and shift consumer drivers and consumer behavior as they think about what they're going to buy, the companies that they're going to support, and the suppliers with whom they want to have a relationship. So again, it's just another way for us to think about what are the evolving consumer priorities, what are the evolving stakeholder priorities, where we now see this bucket of attributes related to productivity and efficiency, and we also have now an equally important bucket of attributes beyond productivity and efficiency for sustainability, ethical treatment of animals, diet and health, all of those things now in that other bucket that is being labeled ESG in today's conversation. So today we have to be willing and able to compete for share of wallet, share of heart, share of mind, and share of voice. Now, historically, we've not done well in all of those areas. We've competed extremely well for share of wallet. We've not necessarily done as well competing for share of heart, mind, and voice. We have tended to focus our conversation and discussion on rational arguments, providing people data, providing people facts, providing them information, believing that that would finally agree, they would finally get the right combination of data and information and come to our side of an issue. What we know today is that social decisions are complex and multidimensional. If we cannot compete on the social elements and the emotional elements, we're going to find our arguments falling short. So we need to have a conversation about how do we expand the conversation we're having? How do we expand the information in our engagement beyond just the rational arguments that we're comfortable making? Now, I'm not suggesting that we should not be science-based. We absolutely need to be science-based. People in production agriculture make decisions to the third place right of the decimal. You have to have good information to make those decisions. But if we're going to engage the public, we have to also engage in the social and emotional conversation if we're going to be effective. So let's spend some time talking about what we know about engaging that conversation in a way that's going to be effective. What do we know about what it's going to take to build trust in animal agriculture and in protein consumption today and going forward? We know that companies involved in animal agriculture, be they in the US or across the Americas, are interested primarily in protecting their freedom to operate. Now that's the ability to do what you do best with a minimum amount of outside interference. Now that interference could come from governments applying more regulation, or it could come from brands or other stakeholders who apply pressure to change practices. And that freedom to operate is based on earning and maintaining a social license. And that's the privilege of operating with minimal formalized restrictions based on maintaining public trust. If the public trusts us to do what's right, they will grant that social license. If they don't trust us, they will impose more social control. And social control comes in the form of regulation or market mandates where brands and others will step into that space and say, you violated trust. We question whether you are trustworthy. We're going to apply more social control and limit your freedom to operate. And we've seen a number of consistent themes challenging our social license today. It could be concern about public health and the impact of animal protein consumption on health. It could certainly be about animal welfare or the environment. Either of those have been long-standing challenges where we've seen social license challenged and oftentimes replaced with greater social control. And that social control can come, as I said before, through legislation, through regulation, through litigation, or from branded companies who simply say, we no longer support that practice in our supply chain. We expect our animals to come from facilities that don't use confinement. We expect our animals to come from facilities that don't use animal health products. We expect different practices, each of which limits our opportunity to be more productive, to reduce our impact on the environment, and to actually provide the care that animals need. So maintaining that social license is absolutely essential. So we know that social license is based on trust. So the fundamental question we believed we needed to answer was, what drives trust? So we partnered with Steve Sapp at Iowa State University, and we began to explore that with a meta-analysis of 21 different pieces of research on what drives trust in food and agriculture. And we identified three primary drivers. The first is the role of influential others. Those are opinion leaders and friends who influence what you think about a particular topic. It could be a doctor, it could be a veterinarian, could be a nutritionist, or it could be somebody down the street or somebody on your Facebook group. The second element in building trust is competency. That's science and technical information. Now, historically, that's where we've spent most of our time in agriculture, talking about who we are and what we do. We talk about our competency, we provide science, we provide data, operating under the assumption that that will somehow be persuasive and will have enough evidence to convince people to trust us. The third element in building trust is confidence, or the perception of shared values and ethics. In other words, can I count on you to do what's right? So once we identified those three drivers, we then surveyed 6,000 consumers in the US over the course of 3 years, asking them questions about food safety, on-farm animal care, environmental issues, et cetera. And what we learned was that confidence or shared values is 3 to 5 times more important than providing facts and building trust. So we've had the historical communication equation exactly backward, because we've always started with data. We've always led with our facts. We've always led with our science. What we now know is, if you don't cross the shared values threshold first, you're not given permission to introduce data. So if I don't believe that you care about what's important to me, that you understand my concerns, and that you understand what's important, I'm not going to give you permission to give me data. I'm going to shut you out and not listen. If at first, though, you engage with me, you understand what's important to me, and you talk about my values, then I'm going to be interested in listening to your argument and the facts you have to present. So it's crucially important that we engage in a new way, understanding that values are 3 to 5 times more important than data and facts in building trust. So let me share with you where we missed the strategic pivot, at least in the United States, as an illustration of an opportunity to improve. How can we think about things differently as we go forward to begin to understand the power of values-based communication in building trust and allowing us to have that social license and freedom to operate? The animal welfare, the animal rights debate was changed in the 1990s when Wayne Pacelli and the Humane Society of the United States came into that conversation. Prior to that, it was really all about animal rights. It was Ingrid Newkirk there you see on the screen, the founder of PETA, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals, a very lunatic fringe group, very far to the left, very far out there, really a fringe group at its best. And really they had this dominant conversation, but it didn't resonate with many. Then when they changed the conversation from animal rights to animal protection, it fundamentally shifted the dialogue. And many of us in agriculture simply missed that. We continued to assume that PETA and the Humane Society of the United States, that animal rights and animal protection were the same thing, and that consumers would think about them the same way, and we missed that strategic pivot. So an animal rights group is really an abolitionist. They believe that all animal production, all animal consumption should be abolished. They believe that meat, all animal protein, equates to murder. The animals and people are equal when you think about the ethical foundation. That eating meat, milk, and eggs is immoral. They use very extreme, edgy tactics. They throw blood on people. They wrap themselves in cellophane trays and lay outside of supermarkets. And it appeals to a very small group of like-minded zealots. But demanding the elimination of meat, milk, and eggs just isn't going to appeal to a broad group. It's more than most of us are ever willing to consider. But shifting the focus from animal rights to animal protection was a brilliant strategy on behalf of that organization. Because all of a sudden now, they're no longer an abolitionist, they're now a reformer. They say, you know what? Hey, we're just like you. We care about animals and the planet that we all share. We don't want you to stop eating animal protein. Just be more aware of the impact of industrial agriculture on people, animals, and the planet. And that mainstream approach appealed to our friends and our neighbors who share similar values. So they clearly understood the power of shared values and use that to their advantage. And their focus on reasonable reforms enabled them to bring in other groups who could focus on public health or the environment or other kinds of topics. But the takeaway from this is that they really understood the power of shared values and they leveraged that. And many of us in agriculture missed that strategic pivot and thought about PETA and other organizations in the exact same manner, when in fact, They have very different strategies, a very different approach, and we should have engaged in that conversation differently to truly earn the trust of those who want to continue to enjoy meat, milk, and eggs. Because fairly commonly, we find ourselves answering the wrong question. Today, people are really asking questions about whether or not we should do what we're doing. Should we house as many animals on an individual farm as we do today? Should we keep them in confinement? Should we use those animal health products? And our historical response has been, well, science says we can. Here's the data that talks about productivity. Here's the data that talks about the economic impact. The challenge is, one is an ethical question, one is a science question. We're not even speaking the same language when we try to answer an ethical question with science or data. And we know that shared values, the ethical question is 3 to 5 times more important, 3 to 5 times more powerful than providing simply data to respond. So frequently, as we've engaged in this conversation, we've missed that strategic pivot and we've been answering the wrong question. So we need to rethink our strategy for how we move forward because our historical approach simply doesn't work. We've always begun by thinking, well, we're just going to delay and hope this issue goes away, right? If I can just pretend it's not there, maybe it will resolve itself. Secondly, we'll rely on science. If that doesn't work, we get more science. And if that doesn't work, we repeat that one more time. We just keep going for more science, believing that ultimately that will win the day. Then we talk about our economic impact, focusing primarily on our sector. We attack those who attack us. And finally, if it's not our sector, we keep our head down. We'll offer quiet moral support to our colleagues, but we don't want to get involved because we're afraid we're going to draw the target over to ourselves, right? That's been the historical defensive issues management approach we've used in animal agriculture. We've got to think about things in a fundamentally different way if we're going to be successful going forward. So let's talk about what that might look like. Let's talk about some specific recommendations for how we might go about reframing this entire conversation, taking the leadership role and beginning to build trust in who we are and what we do in animal protein. Strategically, we need to help consumers understand how animal protein is a socially responsible part of a healthy diet. That's number one. And then secondly, if we're going to compete on the emotional and social side of it, we have to be able to help them understand and support how they live their best life when they're consuming animal protein. So let's talk about the equation for that. Success is starting with that emotional and social reinforcement that animal protein helps me live my best life. And we'll talk like in just a minute. That's the emotional and social side. And then we give people permission to believe that animal protein is important to a healthy and socially responsible diet. That's dealing with the issues. That's giving them data. That's giving them facts. But doing so in a way that's much more likely to be well received as part of our process. So let's talk a little bit about the legacy of how animal protein helps each of us live our best life. If you think about family celebrations, if you think about athletic events, if you think about going to the beach or teaching your children to cook or enjoying a cold glass of milk with a cookie or an ice cream cone with your grandchildren when it's hot outside, any of those events are clear illustrations of how animal protein helps me live my best life. We need to do a better job of celebrating those events and bringing those opportunities to the front of our conversation. People don't want this to be about issue after issue after issue. They want to be able to celebrate the role that animal protein plays in their lives. So when we have this conversation, we need to take it out of the realm of just all of the issues that are being discussed, but to also talk about the great ways that animal protein helps enrich our lives. As we head into the holiday season, it's a wonderful time to have that conversation, because we're going to be getting together, whether digitally or together physically, with family and friends to celebrate the holidays. That's not going to happen without a meal. And most of those meals will celebrate some type of animal protein, whether it's in North America and it's going to be a turkey, or it's in other parts of the world with other types of animal protein. Animal protein will play a key role in each of those celebrations. So let's be sure when we have this conversation that whether you're talking about a food truck on the street or something that you're preparing with your family and friends or a nice restaurant you're going to, let's be sure we share the stories of how animal protein helps us live our best life. And then secondly, we have to tell the story of the farmers and other relatable influencers who are out there every single day making sure that the animals are well cared for, that we're protecting our environment, and that we're producing safe food. But again, it's not necessarily just about the data. It's about the storytellers. It's about the men and women who are out there every single day taking care of animals. And when people raise questions about our production practices or our facilities or the ingredients we use, or, these are the messengers who will be viewed as credible because they can talk about the fact that yes, production systems have changed. We actually do a better job providing for animal welfare today than we've ever been able to before because we have better monitoring systems, because we have better animal health technology, because we have better genetics, because we better understand feed. And when we bring animals indoors, it allows us to protect them from predators and weather extremes and disease. So it gives us the ability to own the ethical high ground, to engage in a conversation that's going to build that level of trust and to really result in that social license and freedom to operate. But it's all about connecting on values first and then sharing information. Just the sharing of information and facts and data is not going to be persuasive. And we need to engage all of those who are involved in animal agriculture because they are going to be the most compelling storytellers. It can't just be the scientists. It can't just be the veterinarians. It can't just be those in government. It needs to be the men and women who are involved in production agriculture on a daily basis because they're going to be extremely relatable because their passion is going to come through. They're going to come across as sharing the values of consumers who are interested in food safety, health and nutrition, protection of the environment, and well cared for animals. But let me offer just one silver bullet warning. This shouldn't be a surprise to anyone, but there is no fast solution to these challenges. As we continue to see society evolve and the way we communicate evolve, we need to understand that we have to be involved in this conversation in a different way, and we have to be committed for a long period of time. One of the challenges we have in agriculture is we are so accustomed to fixing problems quickly that we assume that most problems are fixed quickly. We're able to come up with more efficient feeding programs. We're able to use technology to advance progress very, very rapidly. But as I said before, social issues are complex and multidimensional. There is no quick fix. We have to be committed to being engaged in this conversation, to using new strategies, and to sustaining a strategy over time to earn that social license and protect freedom to operate. This isn't going to be done through a campaign. It's not going to be done through a single public relations effort. It has to be a shift in approach and a commitment to engage in a new approach that's values focused that we're willing to sustain over time. Just a few closing thoughts here as I wrap up. Number one, embrace consumer skepticism. Consumers are understandably skeptical with all of the misinformation that exists today and all of the information they get from social media. It's understandable that people are skeptical. It's not personal. So when they raise questions, they raise concerns. It's not about you. It's a social condition. We've been conditioned to be skeptical. So embrace that skepticism as an opportunity to engage and communicate. Understand that who you are is as important, if not more important than what you know. You may have a vast amount of technical information that could be incredibly valuable. But unless you're able to make that interpersonal connection based on shared values, the power of the information you have to share is not going to have the impact it could. So if you want to maximize your impact as someone who has tremendous technical knowledge, then you need to enhance your skills to communicate using your shared values, because that's the pathway to maximizing the impact of your technical knowledge and your credentials. People want to trust you and they will view your credentials as credible, but you have to cross that shared values threshold first. You have to demonstrate you share the values that are important to consumers in order to earn that social license and freedom to operate. And finally, understand that there is a great desire, a great hunger for more information about food and agriculture. 65% of the public in the US wants to know more about their food. That's a wonderful opportunity. I'm sure the numbers would be similar in other geographies as well. But what a great opportunity for us to be more engaged in this conversation and to help people understand the real value that animal protein brings to society, that it brings to their communities, and that it brings to farmers. So with that, I'm going to close my formal remarks. Again, I can't thank you enough for the privilege of being with you today. And I look forward to continued engagement and for the opportunity to answer any questions or provide any additional insight that we might have time to do today.
Well, Charlie, thanks very much for your presentation. It was terrific. You know, as you were talking and about how do we engage with the consumers, I was thinking about some of the other presentations of the big companies and some of the kind of hard scientific data we had about red meat and causing cancer and other things. How would you assist, say, let's take one example. We had a great presentation by Genus today. How would you help get the message out that gene editing is different, that it's safe, that it's, you know, one of the big concerns in GMOs is that it's transgenic, taking one, you know, trait from one plant, animal, algae, whatever, and putting it into something else. How do you communicate that way in a way that will get consumers to say, hey, this is cool, this is fine?
Yeah, it's a great question. We know from research that we've done, we were very fortunate. We had about 14 different organizations that have done consumer research on how to communicate effectively about gene editing. They were willing to share all of that information with us, and we conducted some primary research as well. I think that the key take home, Lloyd, is really that we need to talk about the application and the solution and not about the technology. I mean, as Elena was talking about what they're doing to provide solutions for diseases that have limited treatment and certainly no cure, when they have the ability to reduce animal suffering and premature death, when they are talking about what's the outcome that we're able to deliver, that is something that people can connect with. That's something where we all share the same value of wanting to reduce animal suffering, to reduce premature death. And all of that results in more sustainable animal protein because we're not providing inputs to animals that don't ultimately provide a meal. And so all of those outcomes are where we need to focus our conversation, not on the technology per se and trying to draw a distinction between cisgenic and transgenic applications, because I mean, CRISPR and talons and zinc fingers could all be used for either cisgenic or transgenic applications. So if we get into a technical debate about the application of the technology, we've missed our opportunity, because the opportunity is really about talking about the solutions that we can provide and how, whether it's in animal agriculture or plant animal agriculture or in microbes, gene editing is providing an entirely new generation of breeding technology that will allow us to solve some of society's most pressing challenges. We can produce the food that we need with less impact on the environment and to assure we have affordable nutrition for more people around the world. Those are the kinds of shared values that people can support. Now, it's important that the right tone be embraced, that we've got the right messengers, that all the rest of those elements are on point. But it's really important that we focus on solutions and not the tool. When I'm gonna go buy a house, or I'm gonna go look at a house, I'm really interested in envisioning myself and my family living there. I'm not really interested in the brand of hammer that's gonna be used to build it. And so we need to focus on what does the solution look like? How can we communicate that and spend less time talking about the technology per se?
Yeah, thanks very much, Charlie. I grew up during a time of the Czechos. We've discussed this, and I can still, you know, recite the commercials by verse, even in song, which I won't do for anyone. Czechos had a lot of money because farmers invested in them, and they don't have that concept around the world. How would you suggest those simple messages about celebrating agriculture, celebrating beef, it's what's for dinner, or cotton, the touch, the feel, or the incredible edible egg. How do we get that into other nations in the Americas and the Caribbean in a way that can have the same kind of impact that those checkoffs had on American consumers during the 70s and 80s?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think one of the really powerful things that's happened with social media, it is democratized communication. And before, as you were mentioning, in the kind of the heyday of the large checkoffs in the United States, there was a lot of paid advertising on broadcast television and in other places that takes an enormous amount of money. You're able to target communication today in a much more effective way to digital influencers and others who can help amplify and multiply the messaging and do so in a way that's much more affordable. And so we have the opportunity to connect with those key audiences using the technology that exists today for communication that helps us reach our target much more efficiently and much more effectively and cost effectively. The key is we have to focus on what's the perceived benefit to that audience in that market. the Thank a Farmer campaign is not consumer centric. We all want to celebrate agriculture, and agriculture should be celebrated, but it's not relevant to people who are buying our products. It's important to us, but it's not relevant to society. And so to talk about agriculture and why people should be grateful we have farmers is not a great use of resource, in my opinion. I think our resources are better spent engaging consumers who are concerned and interested about animal protein, those who are reluctant or hesitant flexitarians that are eating animal protein but feel guilty about it. And we can engage with them in a way that alleviates that guilt. We can connect them to influencers who will help shape their focus and their opinion. And that's being done today all over the world with products ranging from everything that you could imagine. And so that's not a difficult process. It's a different process because we're starting with a different premise that we're going to connect on values and we're going to focus only on what's relevant to consumers, and that we're going to start with values first, and then we're going to support with data. And so it's about celebrating the life, right? When you're talking about beef, it's what's for dinner, or pork, the other white meat, or the incredible edible egg. All of those shared stories of how people were enjoying those products and how those products help people live their best life. They weren't issue oriented. And so issues need to take a back seat. We need to lead with how animal protein helps us live our best life, tell those stories, target the influencers that are most relevant. And we can do that in any geography in a more cost-effective way today than ever before.
Thanks, Charlie. I think your segue into social media helps me provide a good closure for this 2 days of seminars. You can find on social media, on YouTube and Facebook, this event, and it should be up there for a long time to come, and it should be in your Facebook feed and in your YouTube feed. So those watching can go back and look at the presentations. We'll have all the presentations online here at AICA as well. And I know that our partners at U.S. Dairy Export Council will be doing their part as well. I'd like to thank all the speakers. I'd like to thank all the presenters over 2 days, from government officials to scientists to individuals that are renowned in their subjects. And they brought many technical discussions to us in a way that was clear and understandable. And we are going to compile all that information. We'll have a writer talking to you in order to make a very strong contribution to the UN Food Systems Summit next year from the Western Hemisphere, talking about science and innovation, and now hopefully saying it in a way that will be more consumer friendly as we move into that summit so that our heads of states can understand. I want to thank in particular my partners in this endeavor, Nick Gardner at the U.S. Dairy Export Council, and Horace Friazza, someday I'll pronounce his name correctly, at our Washington, D.C. office, as well as his team from our SIA program, our Animal and Plant Health and Food Safety program, as well as individuals here with our information divisions and technology division, as well as all the translators and others that have supported this 2-day event, which is gonna be, again, an important contribution by this institute to discussions that will be conducted by heads of state next year and provide some ammunition for our ministers of agriculture as they go into those discussions in their cabinet, because not everyone looks to agriculture as they should. It all starts with a farmer. It all starts on a farm in order to feed us, in order to hear. When I look at the SDGs that were presented in a variety of presentations, it all starts with agriculture. And so agriculture is key to all of this. And so we're very grateful to your participation, to everyone online. We look forward to continue to talk to you. If you have any questions, please reach out to us here at AICA or at the USDEC. And we wish all of you a good afternoon. Thank you.